moving in slow-mo. I'm a god, but I actually don't know. Homie, better put your pride aside. I'm a Benz, get more like a Volvo. Your best stuff looks like my worst. Synapses, fire, and burst. Got the whole crew with me, body dope damage. You know we ain't average. I ain't gonna set it again, but it's in my time. Better look in my eyes. I'm a genius in the skies, so my heart on my sleeve. You force you a block to a king in his prime. Everybody got a line. Sit back with the stars in line. I finesse like my life on the nine. Was a diamond in the rough, and now I shine.
No one could stop us, they'll try, but they won't. Ay, nada nos puede parar. Oh no. You can't hang with that. So the job beats me, get that money. Mom to the ana, once we go, like a don't own. Then the more don't be out, but no more data. Why? True damage, we do it. True damage, we'll drink it. More than shit, get it. Eat it, then my crew make the beat. I, no one could stop us, they'll try, but they won't. I, nada nos puede parar. Oh no.
Welcome everybody to tonight's coverage of the CCS Novice League Week 1, Day 1. We are here with DZG Sticks and CB Galaxy. I am Whatyourbirdie, and joining me tonight is a good new friend of mine, ICGE. How are you doing tonight?
Doing pretty well. I'm excited to see what Sticks has to offer in this season.
Yeah, always exciting to have a new team on the block. Some players that I personally don't recognize from other incarnations of DZG teams, so I'm excited to see what they'll bring to us tonight. Speaking of bringing us tonight, we've got the bans already coming through. Karma, Kai'Sa, and Xayah off the table. Lots of bot lane focus already throughout these bans.
Yeah, it's interesting how they put so much focus on their bot lane because of how this meta has sort of evolved around just being solely focused on bot lane, but now also some targeted picks and bans in the mid lane. Anikis on that Zed, he's pretty much known as a pretty decent Zed player. So, taking that pick away, and then the Anivia, which after Roa and Saris is now pretty strong pick in mid lane.
Yeah, there's a lot of still really strong meta picks available, as we see CBG on the first round take that Maokai away. If you're watching any LCS, LCK, LPL, you know this champion is disgustingly good right now. Very difficult to kill, super easy ganks, really good team fight. So not too shocking to see him get picked up. A little shocking to not see him hit the ban list at all, but I do like that the teams are focusing more on the comfort picks than on what is actually strong in the meta.
Yeah, it's also interesting that they also, some teams opt into sometimes maybe first picking the Ashe rather than the Maokai, but it'll be interesting to see, actually, no, DZG actually leave the Ashe open. So that does kind of open up CB to pick the Ashe and to pick their bot lane, but with DZG picking the Jarvan and the Jhin, I think Jhin is not the greatest AD carry in this current meta, but we can see that be flexed to support with some pretty decent Jarvan combos to help lock down this Maokai or the potential bot lane.
Yeah, so far there's a lot of flexibility in the DZG draft. Jhin and Jarvan both have multiple roles that they can succeed in. The Braum is not what exactly I would call the meta right now. I do like it. Into what DZG has currently picked up, it's looking like DZG wants to draft this kind of engage death ball run you down front to back kind of team, but the Braum is really, really good against that style of draft with that Unbreakable, the Glacial Fissure, putting in so much work about disruption and slowing down the engages so your team has time to position and make the play happen in your favor.
Of course, right now what I'm seeing, CB have a lot of control in a lot of team fights and a lot of objective control. The Ezreal Braum seems a bit of a weird bot lane, but now Xerath's actually getting picked, so I believe that might be their bot lane, Jhin Xerath, to try to maybe outpoke the Ezreal and Braum. But they still have a lot more flexibility in their draft, so we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, like you said, flexibility. If this Jhin Xerath does get locked into the bottom lane, I do like the amount of poke it brings, and this is really part of the reason we haven't been seeing a lot of melee tank supports is just the amount of poke and power that mage and AD carry supports have right now in the bottom side, it makes the early laning phase and even like parts of the mid game really difficult for these tankier supports to try and manage, as the items that they want are really expensive and they don't have as much access to gold as the mage supports do.
Yeah, that's true. Next set of Ben's focusing a lot on the top side. I believe that Zachman was going towards DGG. I'm surprised that actually not towards banning or DGG up, but not towards banning Zach, but maybe they have something up in their sleeve, as a lot of top side focus in these next bans. So it'll be interesting to see what DGG opts to pick first. I think they might opt in for their top lane and give mid counter pick.
Yeah, a lot of the top lane pool has been pinched down. The Urgot and the Jax really point towards a sort of fightery top laner, someone who doesn't want to get poked out by Urgot in the early game and someone who doesn't want to get outscaled by Jax in the late game. So I'm thinking picks like Fiora, maybe even something like Gwen, maybe Cassante, as that champion is still open and available. DZG is waiting for the absolute last second to lock in, and it is going to be the fighter champion. It's going to be Aurelia.
That was quite an easy pick. And actually, a Vex insta-locked in for a CB. One of them maybe considering that might be Aurelia mid lane, but there's still a lot of flexibility up in DZG's champions right now.
Yeah, there is a lot of possibility for the flexibility. Like you're saying, it could be Xerath mid, Aurelia top. It could be Aurelia mid, bring that Xerath down to support. It could be Jhin support, and we haven't even seen DZG lock in their AD carry yet. There's potential and choices here for DZG in this draft if they really don't like the Aurelia into the Vex matchup, which personally, I don't play a lot of mid lane, but I do know Aurelia dashes a lot, and Vex loves playing against champions who dash.
That's true, and now the orange is locked in. So if they do opt in to send the Aurelia into the top lane, that should be a decent matchup, I'd say, for the Aurelia to get some simple free farming lane. And it'll be interesting. Actually, they opted in for the Gwen, so it will be Aurelia mid, I believe. Yes, that should be it.
There's definitely still possibility for it to be Gwen mid. I would be very surprised if we saw that, but it might be a slightly better matchup into the Vex than Aurelia would be. Again, DZG, I love this draft. I think there's a lot of good flexibility. There's a lot of good all-in. Despite the fact that you have Jhin, Xerath in the bottom lane, they can really support the all-in with that artillery that they have, with the curtain call and with the right of the arcane from Xerath. There's a lot of excess damage that can come over the top, even if your frontline are millions of miles away from you.
That's true, and even with their sort of strong power, they also have a lot of good pressure on the side lanes. If the Aurelia or even the Gwen, both of them get ahead really early on, they can put a lot of focus into those side lanes and just let Jhin, Xerath just hold mid lane and just farm as much as they want.
Yeah, as opposed to the draft that CBG has set up, which is very much 5v5, death ball, we are going to play front-to-back team fight. We've got Ornn for the engage, we've got Maokai for the engage, we've even got Vex for the engage in like a pinch, and just really about making sure Ezreal has the time and space he needs to put out the DPS he wants to in a fight.
Yes, the one thing I am concerned about CB's draft, they kind of lack a little bit of damage if mid or AD carry does fall behind. Granted, they have the Maokai saplings, but still, we're going to have to pay a lot of attention towards mid and bot to see if they can get out of the early game and start getting those 1-2 items.
Yeah, that's going to be the really important part. Getting your mid-game ball rolling and not allowing yourselves to be too passive in the early game, making sure that you have the ability to play the game that you need to. I'm actually getting a phone call from my doctor right now, which was I'm not expecting, so I'm going to have to step away for a little bit. Sorry, ICG, I'm going to have to leave you on the solo cast for a bit. I trust you to handle this.
All right, I can manage a little bit. So I guess we'll just start maybe while they're doing that. Let's do a little breakdown of how these lanes are going to go. Ornn into the Gwen. I've done that quite a few occasions. For Gwen, it should be a fairly simple lane. There shouldn't be too much action. I don't think there's a lot of... Gwen and Jarvan can maybe look onto engaging Ornn, try to get this Gwen ahead. I think most of the action will be towards this mid and bot lane. With the Jarvan, really a strong early game jungler, can look to punish his Vex, especially if she can blow flash early on. That'll help out Aurelia a lot. From personal experience, Scrafty and Andy, Anakis are pretty decent duo. I think they can put a lot of pressure onto the Vex and maybe even look to roam towards the bot lane, try to get this Jhin, Xerath quite ahead. Although on CB's side, if Vex does manage to survive the early laning phase, I think she could have very good roam potential. Because if we look at DZG draft, especially in the bot lane, not a lot of mobility. If they blow flash, that's an easy gank for the Maokai, easy Vex ultimate, easy Ornn ultimate. So DZG are going to have to be a little careful when it comes to these team fights and make sure they don't blow the flash early and they have vision set up in these objectives. Because CB, they want to go in. They are a full five-man dive. We walk in when we want to walk in. DZG, they have to play these fights a lot more carefully. With all that being said, we are going to take a quick short little break, and we'll get back to you as soon as the game starts.
We are back. Apologies for my disappearance, but both of us are here and ready for the beginning of our game one tonight. Looks like the drafts lined up just about exactly where we expected them to. Everything looks pretty normal to me.
Yep, this is just a standard, normal, 5-point, nothing out of the ordinary. Both teams trying to get as much information as they can, try to hold back from invades. I'm honestly surprised CB didn't opt in to maybe attempt an evade with the Braum, with the Maokai, and with the Ornn. Do have some pretty decent CC, however that would kind of stunt their starts. Maokai starting the W, not the greatest. Ornn starting the E into a Gwen matchup. That doesn't really sound the greatest of times. But speaking of the Ornn, I'm honestly interested that he went opted in for the Doran shield rather than the refillable get three melee minions and then get the Doran shield. But I guess I suppose it's more of a comfort for him, probably.
Yeah, the refillable on wave one start has, I think, fallen a little bit out of fashion for a lot of the Ornn players that I've seen. I'm kind of surprised by it, in all honesty. I would have thought that it would be something that would be much easier to pull off in these lanes where you're, like, not going to be really able to trade levels 1 through 3, especially against a champion like Gwen, who has that percentage health, true damage, she's got the auto attack, she loves being up in your face. We've got a bit of a aggressive start from the CB bottom lane. Nice bit of damage into the Xerath, but no stun means that Force Shot gets to come out just fine. And the DZG bot lane is pretty happy with that trade.
Yeah, that's pretty... I believe that's how DZG should play out these fights. Make sure to try the best to not Braum get that fourth auto in. Although, on the opposite end, this is how I want CB to play this lane. They want to get these early trades on, try to get control of the lane before Xerath starts out poking them.
Yeah, the poke from Xerath is really going to be, I think, the important tell in this lane, especially with First Strike, is really opting for that gold generation, get to those item spikes faster, try and just be aggressive and up in the face of this CBG bot lane as early as possible. You can already see the poke coming out on a high legacy, really annoying play against. In the meantime, Sakura's up here on the top side is getting ganked by Angry Present, level 3, just trying to wait out that Ornn dash. He does get the knock-up. Ornn will flash away. We'll be able to survive that, but that's still a flash traded for nothing. A happy first gank for DZG.
Yes, that was a very well-played gank by Angry Present. Just walks up Ornn, doesn't even throw out the EQ right away, tries to bait out the flash. Sakura just holds it maybe a little bit too long, but in the end, doesn't die. So that's a plus for him.
A little bit of early vision from, you know, the kid, just making sure that since they're expecting Dio to be on the bottom side of the map, they want to make sure that Maokai isn't allowed to walk in for free into this bottom lane. They are not the most mobile lane despite all of their range, which means it will be very difficult for them to escape if Maokai does get that aggressive gank on top of them.
Yes, and it looks like that's actually what he's opting into for a bot. Bot gank, but it does get spotted out on the ward. Angry Present currently now focusing on his romp. Looks like they might possibly maybe look to rotate to Contessa Scuttle, as Surprise actually doing some pretty decent trades onto the Gwen, trying to get this wave shoved in to get his reset. Actually, DJ opt in to just contest bot Scuttle. It looks like they're not going to contest top Scuttle and just going to get that pretty much full clear for the Jarvan.
Yeah, we did see Angry Present getting the early recall off thanks to that early topside gank, but it does also mean that CBG were fully aware that the Jarvan had not cleared his bottom side camps, so they were fairly confident that Maokai moving into the bottom side would be a little bit healthier, a little bit stronger, would get to that scuttle first, and with the bottom lane having fairly even priority, the wave pushing towards DZG, it makes it a lot easier for Maokai to say, hey, I'm just going to step into the river, grab this free scuttle crab, not too worried about it.
And with that information, they know Jarvan's going to be into the top side, so it should be fairly free dragon control as mid lane player.
Flash and ignite forward from Spires. The ignite is taking down on the Anakin. I don't know if this is actually going to kill him. It will be first blood, and now Maokai's here to defend. His mid laner Spires will get away just barely, taking that level 6 to get the, not only to get the ulti off, but also just to get enough health to survive that. Angry Present and Anakin both lose their flash out of that play, and that's also going to be the dragon over to CVG.
That was really well played for Spires. I don't believe how close Anakin was to level 6. Maybe he could have maybe potentially looked in for a Q to try to heal off that last stick of night. But that's just a very unfortunate last stick of night. Proceeds to first blood, and now these decks can has a little bit more leeway. She now has the Lost Chapter in, so it'll be very easy for her to stay in lane and look for these future roams towards the bot lane.
Yep, we see you know the kid trying to get aggressive again, taking a huge chunk of his HP thanks to that Ezreal WQ, though. And that's sort of the trade back power that this bottom lane has. You don't really expect Ezreal Braum to be the highest damaging lane, but the Winter's Bite from Braum plus the Mystic Shot from Ezreal, it's a lot of damage in a very short succession that you really don't see coming.
No, especially when Ezreal starts getting Sheen, and hopefully maybe he got opts in for the Essence Reaver into the Vori build. I'm pretty sure that's what he'll opt into, and then shortly after that, he'll just be pumping out massive amounts of damage, and almost maybe even out-trading the Xerath once the Sheen is acquired. It looks like Angry Frenzy might be looking for a topside play.
Yeah, it looks like both junglers are just paving their way up to the top side of the map right now. Angry Present knows that this is probably the spot where Dio wants to be, with the Gwen pushing forward, with the Ornn having level 6. So Angry Present just doing a good job covering his top laner, making sure that there's no trade to be had there. Although it is important to note that both of the junglers do not have that level 6 mark yet, a pretty important spot for both of them to be. And Dio is doing a fairly decent job of farming his camps on respawn, where Angry Present has been a little delayed, I would say, in attempt to get a lot more ganks out onto the map.
Yeah, I think he's trying to get make sure his laners can get ahead. Jarvan, as a standalone, can't really 1v9 a game. He wants this Gwen, and he wants this Aurelia to get as far ahead as they can. But Dio, just doing his best, making sure the Aurelia and Gwen can't get ahead, making sure this lane stay as even as they can, slowly pushing their lead.
Yeah, this state of the game kind of makes me, going back to the draft, kind of questioning this Aurelia pick. I wonder if this is just comfort for Andicus. We're talking about him being a Zed player earlier, Aurelia and Zed having a fairly similar playstyle. You have AD Bruiser versus AD Assassin, but both of them having pretty high mobility. So if this is just a comfort for Andicus in the mid lane, I wonder if you want to cover them a bit more, trying to get some bans towards that pick. The exhaust and the flash burned away from Dragone, but the stun comes through anyway from the Winter's Bite. High Legacy is exhausted, the heal comes through. Dragone is going to live the sliver of HP for now, but Sakrosa is also forced to flash point on the top side with the flag and drag from Angry Present, plus the needlework is going to set him down. Mobility Scooter picking up their first kill of the game, but now Dio is here. Spires has rotated up as well. Fear's gonna come through. Angry Present is gonna flag and drag away. Survive with a sliver of HP. The Vex ulti is gonna land onto Mobility Scooter, which will give Spires the kill. Dragone on the bottom side, living on a sliver of HP. High Legacy doesn't have that level 6 mark just yet, but this is a big wave under tower. I don't think Dragone is gonna be allowed to stick around to clear this one out. Dragone will hit level 6, so maybe there's an option for the curtain call. They're gonna try and pop it open. You know the kid is not gonna hit the stun. The heal comes through. The Unbreakable is gonna tank up that last shot beautifully. And so far, no kills on the bottom side, just big trades of HP.
So much fighting happening all at once, and that is... actually, maybe not.
Ooh, you know the kid stepping up a little bit aggressively. They get the root down onto end of the line. You know the kid now has level 6 as well, that Rite of the Arcane available to him if he wants it. He pops it down. He's going to look for the damage onto High Legacy. It just doesn't have enough. Nice flash away from High to make sure that the Cataclysm will not land, but his support will die in a trade, given his life for the AD carry. But now High Legacy stuck under tower in a 1v4. Maybe he's going to try and make some sort of trade back happen here, look to get onto Dragone, but I don't think it's going to be possible. Dragone is going to pick up the last hit. And Anakis didn't pick up an assist on either of those kills. This is kind of a disaster for this Aurelia in the mid.
Yeah, that is quite unfortunate. Currently, Dale is now pushing in this mid wave. Anakis is going to lose quite a fair chunk of CS. Not getting that assist is going to stunt him quite hard. And actually, the opting to drop in the Retreat, so it's going to force Anakis out off the tower even more. He's going to be very far behind in CS. They opting to let him get all this free CS, but a lot of fighting in the bot lane finally pays off. Dragoon now 2-0 in this gen, getting closer to his item. It actually looks like Ezreal's actually opting in for the Triforce into minion build, if I believe that is how Triforce build. I haven't done that in a while.
Yeah, that is what it looks like. Divine Sunderer is not out of the Hearthbound Axe, so that is certainly going to be a Trinity Force. It's a little surprising. Hang on, we've got End of the Line caught up here. Anger Present is down here as well. The fourth shot is going to land. It's a lot of damage on the End of the Line, but do they have more follow-up? It's just more poke damage from, you know, the kid. Anger Present really didn't want to full engage onto that. They didn't know where Maokai was. Andicus is going to get a little bit of a trade onto Spires here. The Ignite is burned immediately from the Vex, just trying to guarantee that Aurelia will not be on top of them.
I think that was more or less of a panic Ignite, maybe, or just as a means to make sure that Andicus doesn't commit to the engage. As actually, I know the line actually is walking up towards this mid lane. They want to try to get as much dragon control as they can. They do have a lot of their key ultimates online now, the Malkai R, the Braumar, and just trying to, as much as they can, get control of these objectives and make sure DZ can't respond.
Yeah, they were able to grab control of that first ocean dragon, and the second one being a mountain means that there's the potential for 2 out of 3 times it being a very, very impactful soul. You've got the Infernal and the Chemtech dragons, both of which you would be really happy to see. You even got a Hextech soul. All of which you would be happy to get the soul early, get the dragon stack in your favor, but we're going to have to put that on pause. The Andicus is just going to take a huge chunk of his HP trying to get aggressive on this Vex, and this is the counter matchup here. Vex just really easily able to disengage the Aurelia away.
So hard for Andicus to be in this lane. It's so difficult being in this lane.
Spires has rotated down. The Onslaught of Shadows is going to land. It's exhausted, but the True Shot Barrage from High Legacy is going to land that one. And now the second Shadow Surge from Spires is going to guarantee that the kill will go over. Dio will pick up the last hit with the Nature's Wrath. But overall, that's, again, Dragon Control to CVG.
That's exactly what I wanted to see out of Spires. Get these sort of opportunities to roam down towards the bot side and just catch out the Jhin and Xerath that are completely immobile. They don't have Flash. It's just a fairly free and simple kill once his ultimate lands.
And as we see the soul, the Dragon Rift, I would say the DZG is almost kind of saved a little bit by it being the Cloud Soul. It's not the one that has the highest amount of impact. So even if you are forced to give up these next two dragons over to CBG, it's not like a Hextech Dragon or a Hextech Soul where you're suddenly like, oh man, we can't take any fight ever. Or like a Infernal Rift where like, oh hey, if we get poked out, we lose. And speaking of getting poked out, High Legacy gonna be forced to Arcane Shift away, but the Rite of the Arcane finds their mark. Dragon finds the last hit with the bouncing grenades. And that's just High Legacy getting caught out a little bit unawares on that one.
A little unfortunate for High Legacy. And we've been pointing out how CV have quite a good amount of control, but if we look at the goal difference, actually DG is a little bit ahead after that kill into Ezra, so not the worst of state of games, as end of line taking a lot of damage from this poke in the bot lane.
Yeah, thankfully he does have the mountain and the ocean dragon, so that poke will not be as bad as it could have been, but this is the Xerath Jhin lane getting ahead. This is what the poke lane can do. If they can start to transfer their lead in this bottom side over towards the mid lane, over towards the top lane, maybe get on top of the second Herald, DZG needs to start advancing this lead out of the bottom lane. It's only like a couple hundred gold, but at this point in the game, every gold matters.
That's indeed true. I've now seen a lot of the champions now getting their first item spikes. Aurelia has their full build with the Blade of the Ruined King now, so she should be able to 1v9 this entire game. Then opting in for the Gale Force, now to be much more mobile and a little bit more safer. Vex still, I'm assuming, it hasn't taken the recall yet to get that Luden's Tempest. Malkai has the Demonic Embrace, so he's going to be pumping out a lot of damage, especially with the first strike. That's very nice. Ornn's still slowly working towards, I believe that's going to be Jax Sho, possibly Radiant Virtue. I hope it'd be Radiant Virtue over the Jax Sho, just because of how much you want Ornn to be in these team fights, and just how much value Reign of Virtue can give you, especially after it was been buffed. So hopefully that is what he goes into.
Yeah, we are seeing CBG really overload on this bottom side of the map, bringing the jungler and the mid laner down to try and make some sort of play happen. They're gonna find, you know, the kid caught out behind enemy lines. Spires flashes over the wall with the Ignite to pick up the last hit on that one. Really nice punish on the out of position Xerath support. Now Dragon potentially in danger of being dope here. He's gonna sit under tower. I don't think that's the spot you wanna be. End of the line. He's gonna find the last hit on that one, and that's gonna be CBG probably picking up first tower here if they commit all of their resources to it. There was also a play attempted to be made on the top side of the map. Angry Crescent didn't end up getting onto Sacroza, but they are gonna find the second Rift Herald.
That's how Wolf falls. Angry Crescent, they really can't do much about this bot lane right now. Sometimes sometimes you just gotta concede bot tower and just let your bot lane do what they want to do. Try to get whatever they can on the top side of the map. I'm pretty sure Invincible plays when
DZG. You know the kid. This is not the spot you want to be. The exhaust comes through, but it is just to keep you know the kid in line. That's another death for the Xerath, and suddenly this lead in the bottom side is getting slimmer and slimmer.
That is very unfortunate. CB now moving all five members towards this mid lane. They want to try to knock this out, try to get as much mid lane control as they can.
Your president is over the wall, has the cataclysm, finds two, Dio and Sacroza. Dio will flash his way out as the wall falls, a little bit of an unfortunate timing, but honestly, if you are DZG, you're taking an ult for a flash any day of the week, especially the flash off the Maokai.
That's true. They do end up getting them the tower, which does hurt them a little bit. Dragon's up in a minute. CB now Vex finally getting her recall, and it'll be interesting to see what she does get from that back. Actually gets stopped by Dragoon's W.
Nice shot, Dragoon.
That won't stunt them that much. Still 40 seconds onto the Drake. Anger Peasant. You have that Black Cleaver. Black Cleaver's going to help out a lot against this Ornn and Maokai, so it's very glad he's seen him build that rather than Kempunk, which we see quite a few AD junglers build nowadays. So
yeah,
nice
some
to
people
see
would
that.
call the Kempunk a mistake in terms of build paths in a lot of games, and I personally want to agree. I really like the Black Cleaver here. You're looking at Maokai and Ornn, even if the Maokai ends up going a little bit more towards this AD build with the demonic. It's going to give you more value than the Kempunk will, and Mobility Scooter is just going to, under the nose of Sacroza, take this first tower away from him. Just no chance for this Ornn to have the counterplay. I do want to point out, before this Dragon Fight starts, Aurelia has a 50 CS lead in the mid lane with all the roaming that Spires has been able to do, which is really keeping her in parity with gold value versus this Vex. So even in a pretty lopsided counter matchup, Aurelia is maintaining some form of advantage, which is probably the best that you could see in this situation.
Yes, and actually Ornn keeping the lane, trying to see if he can hold him in power, but some of the Herald, see, right here, these you know, they can't contest Drake, so they gotta try to get whatever they can, break it down mid-tier tower. Maybe escort it for a second charge? Okay.
Yeah, we pick up the second charge, but the Shadow Surge is gonna find the Dragoon, who picks him up. Spire Smack goes on a rampage. I know Lion wants to keep this play going. The second Shadow Surge finds its mark as well. Mobility Scooter is going to get tagged by it as well. Spires is just resetting all over the map, looking to get aggressive onto Mobility Scooter, but they will get the blast plant over the wall. Anchor Crescent is forced to flash away the Needlework just to try and keep the rest of CBG slowed down and away from his jungler. And Spires is looking disgusting on this Vex pick right now. Has gotten such a good lead out of this laning phase and is really making the maps see that lead.
Spires is doing so much work for the CB right now. Almost out to his second item. I'm curious how much gold. But when you've made a good point. He's still down 60 CS to this Irelia. Yes, Vex is 5-0-2. But a 500 gold shutdown. If DGD can lock down this Vex, because she has no flash now, if they can lock her down, and maybe the Aurelia or the Gwen can get that shut down, then this goalie can start picking up a little bit. But Spires, really good opportunities are being found with this Vex pick.
Yeah, you'd love to see a player able to actually make their lead matter on the map. It is unfortunate that they've gone down this CS, but with all of the influence that they put on the map, turning that bottom lane into even and then ahead for CBG, and even making this jungle matchup very difficult for Angry Peasant to play, this is exactly what you would hope to see out of a mid laner with a lead. This is the mid laner in solo queue that you're terrified of, because they can just make so much on the map happen.
Yes, and especially if you go to the opposite side of the lane matchup, Andagas hasn't really been able to do much, even though he has quite a massive CS lead, hasn't really been able to do much in any sort of skirmish, and that's kind of goes the same for the entirety of DGD right now. They haven't really been able to do much in these sort of fights. One person gets caught off by Spires, they get bursted, and there's really not much DGD can do afterwards. They're kind of just forced to run away, and it just turns to just easy pickings for Spires.
Yeah, there's still a scaling game happening here. We do have Ornn and Aurelia and Maokai and Gwen, champions who are pretty happy to get to the late game. Champions who are not, like, upset to get to their 3-4 item power spike versus the enemy team. So it's just going to be a matter of, can DZG make it there with the Gwen and the Aurelia? Can Jhin help them make it to that point? Can Jarvan facilitate this Aurelia and Gwen making it to that level? Or is the power that this Vex has gotten in this early game going to be enough to just shut down any hopes that DZG have to get to the late game?
That is a good question that needs to be answered. Ornn just took 13, so...
Ooh, good flash, but you know the kid close. Is going to get away from the Shadow Surge. And I think that's a flash you kind of have to burn, just given how strong this Vex is right now with the Ludens and the Hextech Alternator. It is not someone that you can face check, and especially as this squishy Zera support, you can't really take a single hit from it.
No, not at all. And actually, just tanks a Maokai Sapling. Almost half HP.
Two Maokai Saplings for half HP on You Know the Kid. This is the AP Maokai build that has kind of fallen out of favor, I would say, a lot of times. It's been a much more of a tank Maokai that people have been enjoying, but I do think that the First Strike Red Smite AP Maokai is still here and is still viable, as Dio is showing us tonight.
Yeah, so now they pick up Xandy's. Gonna burn a lot more, especially into Angry Presence, who's now looking to get a little bit more tankier stats, so that'll chunk him out quite a bit more. Although, You Know the Kid now does get this Landry's complete. I'm not sure if he just got that or he's had it. But if you take a look at the gold graph, actually mid lane is almost dead even in gold, despite an almost 80 CS lead.
This is the power of CSing, kids. At home, if you're struggling in your solo queue games, you're looking at your games after, I'm like, oh my god, I've gotten 20 kills in this game, but my opponent laner still has like nearly the same amount of gold as me. What's happening? This is what's happening. This is why last hitting practice is so important, and Anakin is showing that off nicely, managing to keep the mid lane gold the same, despite being down 5 kills and despite not being able to influence the map yet.
It is also very interesting. Gwen has 1 kill and is already up almost 1,000 gold onto this Ornn. So very strong. They're getting their side lanes. They're getting their side laners quite strong. They haven't really been able to do much in the side lanes, which is quite unfortunate. But as we were talking about before, the late game kind of scaling that both teams have. Ornn just hit level 14. So those ornaments will be coming online. It'll be interesting as to who he gives that to. I believe Ludens is either Ludens or Landers is the better ornament upgrade.
The ornament upgrades generally now give about 2,000 gold worth of value. It's really just about which one of your teammates is performing best, which one can really use that extra stat increase. And we see DZG just fully comfortable to give up the Cloud Soul here, caring much more about the potential Elder Dragon that comes out of it rather than trying to get just a single Cloud Dragon for themselves. A Lotus Scooter now on the side lane. The Ornhorn is going to be called. Nice dash over the wall with the Hallowed Mist is going to get themselves out of there, but no flash to be had. It's the five-man squad of CBG coming in to shut down the Gwen. And with that pickup on the side lane, this is an undefended Baron. Aurelia's on the bottom side. She does have TP, but I think this is just a Baron going uncontested for CBG as well.
Yeah, there's not much they can really do to stop this Baron. Spires is walking down to hold mid and make sure they can't get as much. You can't actually. Now they know Spires mid. They're actually walking for this Baron. They might have come for maybe a flip.
Oh, Angry Present. They have vision of the pit for just a little bit longer. He gets it. He nails it. Angry Present with the smite and the flash out. A stylish steal for DZG. But You Know the Kid gets picked up by the Arcane Barrage in the end.
Angry Present doing God's work. That's the jungler I know. That's the jungler I used to play with. He is a smite legend. He does not miss those, and he's trying his best to save DZG from this game. But with that Baron smite, we can still see a look at the gold. It's still dead even. So DZG isn't completely out of the gutter yet. Still have quite a bit of work to do. They gotta get these pretty good fights going on, and they gotta make sure they don't get caught up by Spires. You can't disrespect this. These Vex ultimates. Like I said, you just have to flash him. He's getting his flash and not coming back up. So it'll be interesting to see how they can play around these fights.
Yeah, I do want to point out, interestingly enough, Angry Present is so tunneled in on this two-item power spike that he has opted to not even pick up the boots for himself, has just said, okay, getting my Cleaver plus Gore Drinker is way more important than trying to find even tier 1 boots. It just matters more for me to have that extra value on my shield, thanks to the extra buffs, that 80% AP ratio on that Jarvan W, and just being able to break down this Ornn in the front line, break down the Braum, who's starting to stack up a decent amount of resists himself with the Mountain Dragon on top of it. He's got to make sure that this Jhin, who really is not a tank shredding champion, has the space and has the damage to get through these frontliners.
Yeah, that show Jhin against two tanks. Well, arguably three tanks with the Braum. Not a really fun time, especially even though he does have IE. He's not a tank shredder. He's more or less, let's just shoot Ezreal. Let's just hit Vex. Maybe do some damage, maybe not do damage. Who knows?
Yeah, with the Black Cleaver and the Blade of the Rune King on Andakus, I think there is plenty of frontline and tank shred for this DZG composition. We just can't expect it to be coming from Dragonas. The Ludi Scooter picking a pretty aggressive trade. This throws on the top side. He misses the charge into the pillar. It takes half his HP for it. But that's really just the Ornn versus Gwen matchup right there. You take a little bit of punishment, you lose half your HP, but you're still Ornn. You still are giving ornaments to your team, so you're still feeling totally comfortable.
Yeah, especially now that he's level 15, that's another ornament in the books. I'm curious to see how close he is to level 16, so a lot more gold value going into the pockets of CB. I believe he's opting into the Force of Nature for that third item. Pretty neat. Anger Presence finally now getting these boots, so hopefully he'll be a little bit more impactful maybe.
But, I do think it's pretty funny that even into this AP top lane matchup, this Gwen, he's opted just to go Force of for the Thornmail plus the Steel Caps. Just knows, hey, Gwen might be an AP champion, but it's a lot of auto attacking, and I really need to just not die in these mid-game team fights. So in the side lane, like, if I get taken down to a quarter HP, doesn't matter, I'll TP into a fight, it will be okay. But in the lane, it doesn't, like, matter as much if you have that magic resist just because of how many autos Gwen is pumping out.
Yeah, especially during lane when you got that Jack Show built. Just as Ornn, into the Ornn and the Gwen matchup, you want to do some simple trades as the Ornn. You want to make sure these trades are quick and easy, and with the Jack Shell, just stacking and ramping up armor and MR. Just like you said, this misses the urgency of getting MR in the early lane phase.
Yeah, it's looking at the rest of the map saying, hey, there's a Jhin, an Aurelia, and a Jarvan. These are all high AD threats. Armor is going to be more important for me. Speaking of importance, Ludiscooter, again, just on the top side, having the time of his life, taking down this tier 2 tower and threatening this inhibitor tower. Sakroza, I do not think, can handle him in this 1v1. CBG is going to have to send people back to deal with this Gwen, and as they do, they're going to start losing control of this Dragon Pit with Elder coming up in just under a minute's time.
CBG forcing B back a little bit. High mobility scooter is recalling. I'm wondering if he's going to opt in to just walk into these Drake. Elder is in 40 seconds, so we may be potentially seeing, I think, our first 5v5 in this game. It'll be interesting to see how both teams play it out. CB actually, I know, this death pushing right now. Might be looking for a pick.
Oh, Andakus was looking for high legacy, but does get caught out. Dragon gets tagged by the Shadow Surge. The exhaust is good, though. Dragon is going to survive the full burst. In the meantime, Andakus is on the bottom side, trying to get damage down with the high legacy. Sakroza is going to miss that searing charge, but has the Ornn Horn. The Call of the Forge God picks up the shutdown gold on the 0-1. Aurelia gets the extra gold for himself. Very happy with that one. And that's a pick for CBG going into this Elder Dragon. They might just be able to pick this objective up uncontested as well.
I believe in Anger Present. He stole Baron, he can steal an Elder Dragon. But going back to that fight, that's very unfortunate. You know, the kid actually flashed away from the Vexar and just landed straight onto Dragoon. So forced to flash, forced to kill force. But yeah, I think, well, actually, DZ opting in for the mid lane tower rather than the Elder, trying to flip for the Elder Drake. Definitely a little bit careful here, though.
They're just going to take the tier 2 and opt and say, hey, you guys got the Elder Dragon, great for you. True Shot Barrage is going to land on the Mobility Scooter, just barely missing, you know. The Glacial Fissure somehow finds Mobility Scooter inside of the Hallowed Mist, and that's another pick. Dio finds the last hit on that one. End of the line, trying to get aggressive on the rest of DZG. Yeah, now with the Elder Dragon in inventory, it's going to be so difficult for DZG to defend these outer and inner towers, though they do have a fair number of them left up, so I don't think this Elder Dragon will end the game this time around, but this is going to be a big gold swing for CBG.
It'll be a big gold swing, and also almost potentially a free Baron as well. It just spawned in. CBG opting not in, not to get the inhibitor, but curious if they actually opting in for the recalls, and they'll probably walk straight towards the Baron. They must have a lot of gold on them. This Eldragon almost honestly guarantees them the Baron, unless Angry Pheasant and DG find a way to maybe get a pick onto someone on that watch.
Yeah, we can see the vision control is very much in favor of CBD right now as well. It's not a ton of wards on the map, but the ones that you see are very blue, and there's a lot of them. Just a few red wards on that bottom side quadrant of the map where it doesn't particularly matter right now. The other dragon is down. It's going to be down for another 5 minutes. The Baron is up. The Baron is the target for CBG. They're just looking to get a little cheeky with it. They don't want Angry Present to come in again and get another nice steal on this one. We are just going to be able to clear out this topside red and just make sure that everything is in their favor before they start on this Baron.
As you can see, they know they don't have to immediately and instantly force this Baron down. They can wait a little bit, they still have Elder. And right now, DG, they can't do anything. They're in no position to test this Baron.
And yeah, this is another Baron over to CBG. I see that DZG started to learn from the 100 Thieves school of do nothing and pray that you still win. You do have a Fed Jhin. You do have a Gwen who's on three items. You have a three-item Aurelia. It's just going to be a matter of can you find the point in this game where you can do something with them instead of just letting CBG run away with these objectives, run away with the gold lead that they've gotten so far. Oh, might be a little too late. You know the kid does not have his flash up. Sakroza is going to go on a killing spree revenge for the laning phase that the Lily Scooter has put him through. The Nature's Wrath is not going to find anything. Just a little bit of a zoning ulti to make sure the Dragoon cannot find any sort of damage in return. This is a Baron buff. The other dragon just falls off now. The High Legacy is a three-item Ezreal. This is a scary proposition. DZG has to find the 5v4 fight. There's the Aurelia ulti plus the Cataclysm. This is the fight that DZG wants, but is it too late for them? Anakin is on the backline, trying to get a ton of damage down, but it's just not enough. Sakroza goes on a rampage on the front line. Dragoon is trying to get away. The Shadow Surge will tag in. The Fear of the First comes through from Spires. End of the line, taking beautifully for this mid laner. And now it's just Mobility Scooter, and you know the kid trying to defend. Mobility Scooter finds a 1-for-1, but now it's just you know the kid, and it's open Nexus, and that's gonna be it for game one. CBG are gonna take it home.
Very well played by CBG. I think Spires played that exactly how he wanted to play it. That is just CB executed to that fairly flawlessly, I'd say. No matter where DZG were trying to make play, CB was there, and they wanted to make sure they can get something on the opposite side of the map. Granted, DZG also did the same. They tried their best to play around with their top and mid as much as they can, but it was just too much. Spires, 1v9, carried this entire team, making some amazing plays.
Yeah, Spires got ridiculously ahead, and DZG just had no way to shut it down. It felt like they were very paralyzed on the map, trying to make plays every once in a while, but it was just CB coming in with much crisper, much faster responses. That is going to be it for us for game one. Don't go anywhere. After a short break, we'll be here for game two, where hopefully DZG is going to find their footing in this series and turn it around and bring us to game three. Don't go anywhere.
See it's over if I'm breathing. Racing to the moonlight and I'm speeding. I'm headed to the stars, ready to go far. I'm star walking. Don't ever see it's over.
can't get high up. I know that I'ma die. Reaching for a life that I don't really need at all. Never listen to replies. Learn the lesson from the wise. You should never take advice from somebody that ain't tried. They said I wouldn't make it out alive. They told me I would never see the rise. That's why I gotta get them every time. Gotta watch them bleed too. Don't ever say it's over.
We all sin. If I bring a couple rounds with me, then we all win. I came back and brought that crown with me.
We are back after a pretty exciting game one. We are stepping into game two now. The sides have swapped around. DZG is now on our blue side, and CBG have taken the red.
Leave it, DZG wants. After that little performance there, I want to go for maybe a bit of a different team composition, opting in for the blue side. Can have a bit more flexibility, I'd say, or more pick potential with their first picks. If they potentially have the knock open, they can snag that. If they want to, they can opt in for maybe the Ash, get more of those really strong power picks going. It'd be interesting to see how they choose what to do with this first pick.
Yeah, so far the bans have not changed. Everything's saying, besides the order, pretty much exactly the same as game one. I'm interested to see if DZG will change it up at all, if they have a different game plan coming in on the blue side in terms of bans, or maybe even in terms of picks, because I would, if they're going to let the Maokai through again, I would love to see DZG just snatch that one up.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. Maybe if they don't ban the Maokai here, actually a respect ban of the Vex, afraid of maybe CB taking that early on, and like Maokai is open, so it'll be interesting to see if DZG does take it. I hope they do. Otherwise, that leaves CB quite a plethora of options as for their R1 and R2 pick.
Yeah, if CB does want to early lock down that mid laner, the Anivia that was banned in game one is now available, getting swapped for that Vex ban. It seems indicative of the kind of style that Anakis wants to play in the mid lane. DZG, listening to the casters, obviously, are going to pick up that Maokai. Not too surprising, champion is insanely good in the meta right now, and the immediate counter response of Sejuani and Sylas out of CBG.
It's quite interesting. They do opt in to pick Sylas early on. I believe it's mainly just kind of stunts DZG a little bit with some of their picks. They don't want to give Sylas too much value out of those ultimates in the hijack. Sejuani locked in. Could see some flexibility in top jungle possibly, but Blazer, really Sejuani kind of fallen out a little bit in favors in the top lane, but be interested to see what TDG opt for. Looking like to do their bot lane with the Jinx now locked in.
Yeah, I would love to see some sort of enchanter with this Jinx. We are in a pretty bottom side focused meta, as we've talked about a little bit already. Scaling 80 carries plus enchanters, or even just aggressive dominating bottom lane, something like Caitlyn Karma, Caitlyn Lux, even Caitlyn Ashe. Noticing a lot of Caitlyn. She's pretty good right now, surprisingly, given the style of bottom lane that we've seen so much. DZG waiting for the absolute last second to lock in the Seraphine for themselves. I'm assuming that that's support, just given the kind of player that Anakis is and given what his champion pool would show us. But Ari, we're seeing a couple of pretty insanely good ultimates for Sylas to grab in this DZG comp.
It'll be interesting. I'm assuming ZB might just mash 80 carry for 80 carry here. A lot of their options are still available. Like you said, the Caitlyn's still up, the Ashe is still up. Could opt in for Jhin themselves, but I'm not a huge fan of that. Caitlyn will be locked in. Try to get as much power as they can out of this bot lane pick.
Yeah, now it's up to DZG. Are they going to continue to focus down that top lane pool, try and make it safer for Mobility Scooter to have a more comfortable matchup? Or are they going to pinch down on this support pool, try and make it so Caitlyn doesn't have as many good pairings? I can see two bans really easily for them just being the Lux and the Ashe, trying to take away as much of the bottom lane power from this Caitlyn as possible, make it so Jinx has a much more comfortable time scaling up into the mid and late game.
I think it's a little bit difficult to ban out some supports for the Caitlyn. As I say that, they ban Lux. But even if they do ban the Lux and if they do ban the Ashe as well, that still leaves Kayn Morgana, which I still think is, in my opinion, one of the stronger pairings with Caitlyn. But now that Aurelia get him away, pinching a bit more towards the mid lane, which makes me believe they might actually opt in for the Anivia pick for the mid lane.
Yeah, my only question would be if it does go unbanned, which it does not, DZG is going to take it away. I would wonder if they would have done that blind and tried to save counterpick for their top side. But now with the Anivia out of the way, this is two of the champions that we would have expected to see Spires on. Now we're reaching a little bit deeper into the champion pool, although that's also honestly a little bit of a strange ban, as the Sylas is already locked in, and you would kind of expect that to be the mid lane. It's technically flexible. We have Sejuani potentially going to top and Sylas maybe headed towards that jungle. But as CBG are going to lock in the Nautilus, they're going to keep that flexibility. So DZG can't be 100% certain where the Sylas and the Sejuani are going to end up. So they're blind picking one lane no matter what they do here.
It'll be interesting to see what they do opt to pick in here. I believe Vancouver for a safe pick. A lot of the top laners from last game are now open. The Jax, the Urgot are open. Actually, opting for the Poppy. So I believe
really
that I go
like
to
Poppy here. This is a really good Poppy game to be in. You're versus a Sylas who has so many dashes it's difficult to count, and Sejuani, whose main engage tool is that dash alongside Nautilus. So it's really, really nice counter and disengage for DZG. It's going to make it so much more difficult for CBG to actually find their way into a team fight.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. Maybe Anakis opts in for a bit more of a lockdown, maybe opt in for the Talia, although they'd be they opt in for the Victor is kind of more of a safer pick, I'd say, into the Sylas matchup. It'll be interesting to see what Sakroza, sorry, can't speak his name. It'll be interesting to see what Sakroza does, and what if they might opt in to keep the Sejuani into the top lane, Poppy into Sej. It's okay lane, I guess, but actually opt in for the Mordekaiser.
Yeah, that tells me that it's going to be Mordekaiser in the top side, Sejuani jungle, Sylas mid, unless we're seeing some insane meta read counterpick where Mordekaiser somehow has a good matchup into Victor. I would be very surprised if that was the case, but I think Mordekaiser has a fairly good matchup into Poppy, a champion without a lot of dashes who really can thrive against champions who don't have a lot of mobility, like Poppy. So it's just going to be a matter of, can Poppy tank enough to get through this Mordekaiser laning phase?
It'll be very interesting. I think Poppy being tanking into the Mordekaiser, quite difficult. Mordekaiser just thrives against in the tank matchup, so honestly, knowing Angry Peasant as a jungler, I could see him picking Sejuani, Sylas, or Mordekaiser. I could see him picking all three, so don't really necessarily fully know who is going to be playing in the top lane, but if I had to guess, probably you're right. Mordekaiser top, Sejuani jungle, Sylas mid. Kind of just a standard little setup they have there.
Yeah, the really, I think the only thing that's like incredibly worth noting here is this Nautilus in support. It's not generally the best pick, I would say, right now. It is good to have that engage and go button, and we have been missing a lot of engage supports in the meta right now, but generally it's just been enchanters and lane power. I think I would have preferred to see something like Morgana. That Black Shield already into this DZG comp has so much value. And like you were talking about, Caitlyn Morgana, a very, very aggressive and oppressive lane to play against, especially as Jinx, someone who can struggle to output damage in the early game.
True, but I think even now with all the, I believe it was this patch that all the melee supports got quite substantially buffed. I think possibly they have more favor towards these more engaged style supports. Yes, the enchanted supports are quite decent. But if you look at the Kayn Nautilus matchup, if they manage to lock down either the Jinx or the Seraphine, especially early on, their damage output is going to be quite insane. They're going to have a lot of prio into the bot lane, and it'll just be interesting to see how both bot lanes play out, especially in when it comes to these first or second Drakes, especially in these team fights. DG have a lot of they can play both the engage and the disengage aspect, whereas CB, they have a lot of pick potential with Sejuani, with the Mordekaiser, Deathrealm. It'll just be interesting to see how both teams play this out.
Yeah, even with Sylas grabbing the Nature's Grasp from Maokai and the Encore from Seraphine, there's a lot of pick potential for the CVG comp. It's really a lot of just single target, we are going to lock someone down and not let them play the game. Yeah, like we were talking about, DZG has a really, really disgustingly good teamfight composition. If they can buy space for this Jinx and allow her to play these fights, and I think, importantly, not concede too much in the early game. I think that was a big problem of what we saw from DZG last game. They were a little too passive on the objectives. They were a little too unsure to be stepping into teamfights, and it really allowed CB to take control, take reins of game one, and just run away with it, essentially.
Yes, but all that running away with losing a lot of in the early game was on the back of Spires, that Vex, putting a lot of pressure into this bot lane. Now onto the Sylas, so it'll be interesting to see how he can manage that. Sylas, not as global, I'd say, as Vex is, but it'll be interesting to see if he can still make some plays down towards this bot lane, get this bot lane ahead, and get as much control as he can in the bottom side of the map.
Yeah, post 6, Sylas still definitely champion, that can roam a lot, and my goodness, ICGE, all of this casting and all of this talking has really gotten my throat parched. Do you know if there's any sort of product that might be sponsoring our stream tonight that could help me out with this problem?
I think I do, yes, and I think it starts with the letter D, I think.
It might just be we are sponsored tonight by Dubby. They have been a consistent sponsorship with DZG for a decent amount of time now, so thank you to Dubby for sponsoring us. They are an energy drink company that has a lot of health benefits. Their drinks contain vitamins, amino acids, and a little bit of caffeine derived from the seeds of coffee plants. Dubby, importantly, has no sugar, no maltodextrin, filler, no artificial colors or dyes, and is totally gluten-free. And if you use the code that you see in chat below, DZGWIN, you can get 10% off of your entire purchase, including a starter pack with a shaker and 3 sample flavors.
You highly recommend it. It is quite good.
Yeah, I've got a tub of Dub Sludge in my pantry right now, just waiting to continue to be used. I might make some after this cast, actually. But speaking of waiting a little bit, we are in the spectator delay, so we are going to turn it over to a short break as we step into the waiting room for our game 2. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Hold our heads up high and beat the drum through what we love.
Are back for game two. We've already got a pretty interesting start. The early invade coming out from CB, and immediately we got a pause coming out of the gate.
They want to remake. They got spotted on the word. They just want to remake it.
Go it's again. Just like it's just like LCS scrims. The level one doesn't go well. All right, remake it. Run it back. But no, it does look like there is some internet issues coming through for CB's jungler. I'm sure that will be resolved shortly. We can hope and pray at the very least.
Hopefully, yes.
I do want to point out a couple of interesting things here. We do have double teleport for CB Galaxy versus just the one for DZG Styx. The first strike on Maokai without the red smite, I think, is a pretty interesting choice.
I think... I'm not a huge jungle person. I'm not 100% knowledgeable on it, but I think not going red smite is okay, especially with the first strike Maokai, just simply because he'll most likely just go demonic straight into the more tankier style, Radiant Virtue, maybe Mecha Redemption. That is a bit of a build that we have seen a few times. I know it happened today in LCS. Demonic Embrace into Radiant Virtue Redemption. So try to get as much power out of that mythic item as they can.
Yeah, I think especially depending on what dragons we see, that Chemtech Dragon also applying the extra heal and shield power can really amplify that build. We do have Hextech Dragon as the first dragon this time around. The Spectator client finally has given us an icon for the Hextech Dragon since it was added to the game. I don't remember how long ago. Too long ago.
It was, oh god, I think it may have almost been almost 2 years, maybe.
I think it's been almost 2 years where we've had the Hextech Dragon. And just a couple patches ago, we finally got its icon in the Spectator client. Praise Riot.
I feel old now. All right. Well,
you think you feel old? Back in my day, there were three viable top laners: Mundo, Renekton, and Shyvana. Anything else was trolling.
Now it's whatever you want.
Now it's, yeah, pretty much whatever you want. We do have in the top lane a pretty unusual matchup. We've been seeing Mordekaiser here and there as a bit of extra AP for teams, plus a magic damage side lane threat akin to like a Gwen, just a little bit tankier, a little bit more pick power. And the Poppy is a champion we've been seeing a lot in the jungle in the past couple of years, but really in the top lane has been sort of falling out of favor.
A little bit, yeah. I think more or less, maybe kind of as a vacuum answer to maybe the Mordekaiser. You know, if Mordekaiser seems to be a bit scary with the Death Realm, probably can just choose to maybe ult him or any other member of CB Galaxy away. Just get a free
nice level one from End of the Line, Unknown Kid. Or you know the kid, sorry, not unknown. We know the kid. He's gonna lose half of his HP in that trade. They'll get some nice autos back onto End of the Line, but that is still a lot of damage onto this very squishy Seraphine.
Especially on in the earlier levels, the Seraphine doesn't have access to that empowered W. Has a
looking engage again. High Legacy is going to be zoned out by the traps, though. End of the line taking plenty of damage. The flash is a little bit late as Anger Pressing got over the wall with his own flash. You know the kid, he picks up first blood.
Very unfortunate as Mikoso taking quite a lot of damage. Very unfortunate for End of the Line right there. It does end up actually throwing that hook straight into the wall, and thankfully Scrafty was there, or Anger Present, sorry, is there. Get clearance drugs to get a little bit of advantage as Kroza.
Kroza taking lots of damage. Mobility Scooter has the flash, but is not going to opt to go under tower for it. Dio is here to defend their top laner. He's taking plenty of damage. Flashes onto the shield to give themselves just that extra bit of health, but I don't know if they'll be able to survive. Dio is taking a lot of damage from these minions. Mobility Scooter flashes forward to find the kill. They get picked up by Dio, but Sakroza gets no assist. It's the jungler top laner 1v1.
That's exactly what I wanted to see out of UUSD. Try to get a little bit more power ahead as Anakis getting caught up by Spires again.
Yeah, taking plenty of damage. Learning the ghost there just to make sure that Spires can't get any further follow-up. And Mobility Scooter's gonna teleport back up to top lane just to make sure Mordekaiser can't get away with free farming this lane. Neither of them have flash, but I don't think Poppy is gonna go for the under the tower stopping the recall this time around.
I think it's quite unlikely. Sakoza just gonna trade teleport for teleports. Might lose a bit of CS. I'm not 100% sure if this was a cannon wave or not. Lose maybe two, maybe three creeps or not. Not that very much. But yeah, this is what I want to see. This is what I want to see. VZG making these plays early on. Granted, some of it was a bit of a throw on the side of the bot lane for CB Galaxy. But still, this is what I want to see. Anger Peasant there in bot lane, helping make sure they can get ahead, and Mobility Scooter just want to be 2-aing in the top lane, especially on this Poppy pick, into arguably kind of a really bad matchup as Poppy.
Yeah, you picking up that Buckler is pretty telegraphed, which makes it very difficult for Mobility Scooter to pick that shield up safely, as we see an aggressive trade in the mid side. Just Spires taking advantage of the early game weakness of this Victor pick, and now Angry President is sort of forced to sit under tower here and help defend his Victor, make sure that there's no dive available. End of the line is gonna get in with the hook under tower, finds the last hit with that over the head auto attack. Dio is up top again, gets charged under tower, but the stun comes through. Mobility Scooter gets picked up.
Very well played by both the jungle and support of CB Galaxy, trying to get opportunities, try to fight back a little bit after a little scuffed plays here and there from both DSG and CB Galaxy, but overall quite a very good trade out of that. Anakis didn't have the flash, so that's nice, but Spires did. So that could opt in for maybe Angry Peasant to go back and visit this mid lane and see if they can get Anakis a bit more ahead.
Yeah, it is really important to get this Victor and this Jinx out of this early game as close to unscathed as you can. Obviously, they're going to take some hits and it's going to be a difficult time in the lane, especially versus a bully like Sylas and a aggressive lane like the Caitlyn and the Nautilus, but as long as DZG can keep within, I would say, like a 2,000, 2,500 gold in this early game, and they don't fall too far behind, they're feeling fairly comfortable in this game.
Yes, they are, but if we take a little bit, quick notice towards the top side of the map, we're really sort of done. Quite a substantial amount of CS, even though after getting a fairly good kill from the top lane. Be interesting to see if how much that actually dramatically affects the lane. Interesting to see if Mobiscor is ahead or behind in gold, but I think if you saw anything from last game, CS versus kills, CS is going to win, so I'm assuming Sakurosa will be a little bit higher up. DZG actually opting for this Drake, but CBR considers a response.
Yeah, they do have four people down. It looks like CB is just going to opt to give this one away. The priority in favor of DZG means that they're going to be first to the pit. Dragon's already down about under 1,000, which means, yeah, they picked that one up for free. Really nice rotation. Good early pickup.
Sakurosa looking for a little bit of a play. It does miss the pull. I believe maybe the North Bank might opt in for the Death Realm to play. But Mobile Skirter just chunking Sakurosa with these Qs.
It's sometimes hilarious to realize, like, the matchups that are happening in League of Legends. You've got this 8-foot-tall armor Lord of the Realm of Death versus this cute Christmas Yordle who's just throwing bucklers at him and is somehow hurting him more than he's hurting her. Sometimes just looking back on this game is very funny.
It is very funny. But if you go back to the gameplay-wise, Poppy with that buckler, especially with the grass procs, we'll just start chunking out those Morkais, especially if Mobility Skirter opts in for the Divine Sunder, which I believe is what the standard build I'd say is made for the Poppy. If she starts getting those Sheen procs with those grass and the bucklers, we'll start chunking, especially now. Tank the entire Q combo right there, so just shows the power even without a damage item. Mobility Skirter cannot be underestimated with these Qs.
Yeah, but speaking of being underestimated, while we're looking at the top lane, we do have to point out Mobility Skirter's down 30 CS, and it's just a kill versus an assist. It's not like Spire's in the last game where it's 5 kills versus 50 CS. We're gonna have to put that on pause as Spire's is gonna be forced to flash away, but the flash forward from You Know the Kid to find the root, into the root, into the stun, and the Kiss is gonna pick that one up. The Glacial Prison is burned from Dio, but it's just too little too late.
Very good from DZG, trying to get Anikis. A bit more of those hex core upgrades. The assist will help out quite a bit. Spire's a little too far, well, not too far ahead. He was quite far up, but did try to make a comeback. Stole away the Seraphine ultimate. Tried his best, but it's just too much damage, too much burst.
Yeah, he's going to be forced to burn that teleport just to get back to lane and pick up that wave. I do like Anticus just using the Chaos Storm there. Pick up the wave, clear it out, make sure it hits the tower, and force that teleport out of Spires. Because if the Sylas is allowed to keep that teleport as we get closer and closer to that 14-minute mark, there's potential side lane plays that can happen with that Unleashed Teleport. So good that that's going to be on cooldown by the time we run get around to that part of the game.
Yes, indeed. And I also like what CB guys are doing now. They're leaving the Caitlyn alone in the spot lane. They know Caitlyn's fairly safe enough. Press Q, the wave is pretty much almost half dead. And end of line just roaming around with his team, trying to see if they can find a play. Do manage to get the Rift Herald, but I like Z taking a bit of damage, but still fairly comfortable in this lane on his own.
Yeah, like you said, Caitlyn, a very safe laner, very difficult to actually get aggressive on just because of that 650 auto attack range. It's so difficult to get close enough to her where she's not hitting you, where you can actually apply some bit of threat, especially with, You Know the Kid just now hitting 6. There's a potential for something to happen, but we already see Spire's and end of the line starting to rotate down. If You Know the Kid sticks around a little bit too much, they might just be in trouble. End of the line has the flash. They might look for some kind of play, but it looks like they're just going to peel off of it instead.
Like, they'll hover in top lane a little bit. And I'll try Maybe might even look this play onto the Poppy as Angerfoot's also looking to play in the bot lane.
There's the Nautilus hook and doesn't have the level 6 yet. The charm only finds one, but the Sun comes through. High Legacy is going to find the kill in the return, but Dragoon, who should be able to pick this one up with the Super Mega Death Rocket and end of the line, should fall as well. Just as soon as Jinx gets enough autos through. But Ability Scooter, in the meantime, trying to get away in the top side. The Death Realm and the Glacial Prism were burned, but Poppy, just a little too slippery, manages to find their way out of that 2-1.
Ars is looking. He thinks that, ooh, and just barely, Mobility Scooter gets out. Very well played by DZG and both, on both sides of the map, Mobility Scooter playing that very well, avoiding the Death Realm, and avoiding the Sejuani, getting the pick on the other side of the map. DZG playing very well, Dracoon now 2-0, getting the Jinx very much more ahead.
Yeah, kills on Jinx are so incredibly valuable in this early game. The faster you can accelerate her to that 2-3 item power spike, the sooner you have a real AD carry on your team and you have the potential to play around her. As end of the line, looking for the hook on Angry Present, doesn't manage to line it up this time. But you know the Kid and Anticus are close by, so I wonder, even if that hook lands, if that's exactly the hook that end of the line wants to find.
I think that hook could be a little bit suspicious because it was just end of line, and I believe it was just Spires that was in the bush right above him, so it'd be a little scary if that hook did connect. I'm not sure if they would have that much damage, but the Mountain Dragon has spawned in. Both teams trying to get as much control as they can into this river. Spyros does not have to teleport, but is now pushing in the mid wave and looking to get some mid prior and maybe walk down towards this dragon.
Yeah, High Legacy and Dio are both going to be on vision. That Scryer is not going to see the ward, actually, so DZG will have full information of this dragon being started. They're going to get Pink Ward down in the pit to maintain that vision, and a Kiss and Mobility Scooter rotating down. There's the Nature's Wrath from Angry Present, just getting the roots down. Nice two-man root from You Know the Cade. Finds its mark. Mobility Scooter is rotated down and picks up High Legacy. The Encore is not going to find its mark, but Dio now trying to get aggressive on the Anticus will not find it, but in the meantime, Dragoon on the front side of the fight picks up the Nautilus, goes on a killing spree, and Sacroza trying to get away. It's a double kill now for the Jinx. They're going to donate every kill to Dragoon. It's a triple kill for the Jinx. Spires is forced to dash away. And suddenly, this Kraken Slayer Jinx is 5-0, and DZG is in a much more comfortable spot.
That was very, very good. Well played by DZG. Mobility Scooter Anagus walking in from the mid lane. The rest of DZG walking in from bot lane. Pincer CB Galaxy in this mid lane. And like you said, Jinx, Kraken Slayer 5-0. Very well played. He's not very far ahead. Ooh.
Flash forward, end of the line. They are going to find You Know the Kid. They're going to pick that one up, but that's burning a flash just to pick up the Seraphine. It's a fine, like, secondary pickup at the end of that play, but it's still sort of like a consolation prize, you know?
A little bit, yeah. And especially, but okay. If we look back at that fight, it's a little unfortunate for CB Galaxy. Sacroza comes into the fight, doesn't actually have the Death Realm, so couldn't really turn much of the fight. He was in pretty decent position, could have ulted in. Could have ulted Dragoon, but just very poor timing, I'd say, for CB Galaxy. They tried to take that fight, but DZG played that extremely well.
Yeah, super, super nicely played. We are going to see Dragoon taking advantage of the crit item changes. Is going to go for that Infinity Edge second. And speaking of itemization, I do want to point out that Mobility Scooter has opted for the Iceborne Gauntlet in the top side, not the Divine Sunderer that we may have been originally anticipating. But a much more tank-focused build, and something that I think honestly might even be better in a 1v1 if Mobility Scooter's goal is just to survive.
I think it's Iceborne Gauntlet, kind of a, in my opinion, a bit of a weird purchase, especially since Sacroza, Deo, and Spyros are all AP damage, and the only real AD threat is High Legacy. But I think overall, Mobility Scooter wants to just be as annoying as possible, especially in these team fights with the Poppy ultimate and with these kinds of slow fields. I think it'll be quite interesting as good trades being placed on the top side.
Yeah, Angry Preston is up there. They're going to be spotted on the pink ward. They won't go for the gank. They're just going to grab that information that the pink ward is there and leave a little present for Sacroza and Dio in case they try to make something happen. There is something worth mentioning on that Iceborne Gauntlet, the extra passive that comes out of that slow field. It's similar to Glacial Augment, where if you're in the field, you will do a little bit less damage, but as opposed to Glacial Augment, it's a bit greedier, where if you were in the slow field, you will be doing less damage to the person who casted it, as opposed to everyone else except them.
You know, I totally forgot about that. Top lane player, by the way.
It's not an item that's like very commonly built, and I think it's honestly for champions who like Shanes really being underrepresented just because items like Essence Reaver, Triforce, Divine Sunderer are so incredibly good. Most of the time, if you're playing like a Bruiser or a Tank, you would rather have the Sunderer as opposed to the Frozen Fist, but in this case, I think Mobility Scooter is making the right call.
Yes, and as we saw the gold draft a little bit, Dragoon 2k up over this Caitlyn.
Yeesh.
Give it a little bit more time. Jinx currently sitting on 1k gold. Give her another 1k. Actually, first tower now. So, inching ever so closely to that IE second item would be just an absolute monster in these future fights.
Yeah, that two item breakpoint, really the power of these late game AD carries now because they have access to that Infinity Edge a little bit earlier. I do like that High Legacy has opted for the Kraken Slayer here, just trying to get through the front line that is going to be Mobility Scooter. Normally, you're seeing Caitlyn's go for, like, Heal Force plus Rapid Fire, but I think that build has sort of gone its way now with the way the meta has shifted, and especially with the crit item changes. Rapid Fire second feels really bad.
Yes, but right now, she has a Kraken Slayer and a Longsword, which makes me believe she might maybe opt in... It might help them for might be an LDR maybe second item on the
kill. LDR, BT, Phantom Dancer. There's a lot of choices here, but what we can say about that is probably not Navori, which means it's not going to be a crit capstone second item, which will delay Caitlyn's power just by that little bit.
Yes, especially compared to this Jinx where Caitlyn, she wants to try to get as much damage as she can. So it's very interesting not opting for an IE. Jinx, I believe after this wave, should now maybe almost have IE built. Although it has to be a little bit careful, these three members are trying to get as much vision as they can for this Cloud Dragon.
Yeah, it is worth mentioning, for our second game in a row, we got the Cloud Rift Soul. So, similar to what DZG did, if CBG don't feel comfortable enough taking these fights, if they don't feel like they've hit their item breakpoints, if they don't feel strong enough, they can just seed this third and fourth dragon and try and play around the Elders. But it does look like CB Galaxy are going to look for a contest. Anger Present, the Sapling is perfectly placed. It's going to get full information of the entire CB Galaxy team there. Mobility Scooter just hanging on to that steadfast presence, making sure Spires has to think a little bit before he takes that engage. It's just a 5v5 standoff. That Cloud Dragon has spawned. CB Galaxy have control of the pit, but it seems like DZG aren't too worried about it. They have the Maokai and the Seraphine ultis to get themselves into the fight. They've got the engage they need. It's just a matter of when do they want to pull the trigger. Just waiting on it. It looks like neither team wants to be the one to do it.
Yeah, DZG, they're playing this really well. They don't need to force it. It's a Cloud Dragon. In my opinion, kind of the lesser needed Drakes of all of them. So they don't need to overly push for this dragon. They're fine trading it, especially if they can get the power, which is what they're trying to put a lot of focus onto. Anger Present kind of just gatekeeping them, make sure they can try to escort this wave into the mid tower and force it down. And now they just get mid tower for free, so it'll be interesting to see if they just start walking to Drake now.
Yeah, they see two show up on that mid wave, which I think means that DZG will just, yeah, walk in and take full control over this dragon pit. This is beautiful macro from the DZG team, knowing they don't have to overforce, they don't have to be the ones to immediately pull the trigger. They are going to start the dragon, and the Knight's going to get knocked up from the Nautilus ulti. The Poppy ulti is going to knock two people away from the fight, which means DZG is fully winning in this situation. You know the Kim's going to find the last hit onto Dio. Sakroza is in the death realm with Mobility Scooter. The rest of DZG is just standing on top of the dots, making sure that there's no place for the rest of CB Galaxy to come and help. And that's going to be the dragon secured for DZG.
That was almost picture-perfect League of Legends right there. DZG, no, they don't need to overforce anything. Just play the simple game and force CB to make a choice. Do they concede mid tower and try to burst down Drake? But inevitably, they gave mid tower, but they couldn't do anything about the Drake and are forced to. They were forced to concede it, but then they opted to continue the fight. But unfortunately, Mobility Scooter, really good Poppy ultimate, forces two members away, and it's just free pickings for DZG.
Yeah, that's, like you said, picture-perfect League of Legends. CB Galaxy was forced between two, honestly, bad situations for them. They can either try to give the mid tower and try and burn down the dragon, but if DZG turns, they know that DZG is stronger in the 5 versus 5, or they can try and sit and defend the tower and let DZG have this third dragon. But if they do, suddenly they're staring down the barrel of a Cloud Soul, which doesn't feel super comfortable for them to look at.
No, it does not. Crozet has managed to get the pull onto mobility because it does have the Rylai's, but is it doing that much damage?
Yeah, despite kinda Poppy just building pretty much full armor, this is a very even trade. So Crozet does have that shield for the extra bit of healing. There goes the... Oh, I always forget the name of that ultimate. It's escaping me right now, but the Poppy ultimate is just going to knock Sakroza away from the fight. So if Mobility Scooter is ever feeling in any sort of danger, can just say, hey, we're no longer fighting. Goodbye.
No, especially for how short of a cooldown this is. It's already almost a quarter of the way done, so just put a lot of more pressure, I think, onto the side lanes. Poppy can just do whatever she wants in the side lanes. She does not care. Although she is a little bit behind in CS, is 30 CS down over this Mordekaiser, but going by the item-wise, I think Mobility Scooter is ahead, just simply because Frostfire, Iceborne Gauntlet, like you said, now looking towards this Sunfire Cape, whereas Mordekaiser, quite a bit behind. I believe that's Mordekaiser builds
probably
Rylai's.
A Jack Show second.
Yeah, I would say, I believe he goes to Jack Show second. So once he gets the item, be a bit more tankier in these team fights, maybe might be able to do a bit more damage to Mobility Scooter, even though he is stacking full MR, or not MR, armor. But if you look down towards the bot lane, High Legacy does have a Vampire Acceptor, so it might actually be opting into the Bloodthirster, like you said, not too long ago. But Dragoon has the IE completed and is looking towards, I believe that's looking towards a Ruin's Hurricane, I believe.
It's either Runans or Rapid Fire, depending on what that next purchase is going to be, either the Kurchus Shard or another Dagger. Both build out of a very similar build path, but I think both are good in this situation. RFC just giving that extra bit of range, extra bit of safety for Jinx to get that first reset and really be able to open up in a team fight. But Runans also, like, in the team fights, in these very standard 5v5 front-to-back fights, it's just so much splash damage and extra value for this Jinx to flash forward from Spires and from End of the Line. They're looking for the shutdown onto Dragoon, but it's just the pick turned around onto them. It's a two-man charm from You Know the Kid as well. End of the Line is going to give over the double kill. The Super Mega Death Rocket is going to take a chunk out of High Legacy's health bar. Dragoon does not have the flash, but Anakis does! Goes forward and picks up the Caitlyn now into Death Realm, just trying to kite out his Mordekaiser as much as possible, sidestepping the Obliterates beautifully. Dragoon goes legendary, 8-0 on the Jinx, and that's going to be a free Baron for DZG as well.
Very unfortunate for CP Galaxy. End of Line did end up missing the hook onto the Jinx as Mobility Scooter and, you know, get forcing Dale away. But like I was just saying, End of Line missed the hook onto the Jinx. Spires going a bit too deep, trying to get this Jinx shutdown going on, but now Jinx 8-0-5, really strong. And if DZG keep playing the game that have they playing, it should be very smooth sailing. Jinx does opt in for the RFC, so a bit more range, and it'll just be a little bit more safer in these fights.
Yeah, again, like I had said, just that first auto to come in from safety so Jinx can get that reset. Whether she gets the kill or not, at this point in the game, I don't think particularly matters. She's already 8-0. She has accelerated to that third item breakpoint. She's nearing on that fourth item. She's nearly halfway there. Whereas Caitlyn is still sitting on 1.5. It's just, this is what happens when your late game scaling comp gets that little bit of a lead in the early game. Suddenly Caitlyn has no influence on this game, can barely scrounge together a second item, and is no longer like doing the damage necessary for her to be a bully. She's two levels down on this Jinx. It's so difficult for High Legacy to get anything done in these team fights.
I think a lot of credit has to go to Angry Peasant as well. The Shadow Moon, actually.
A little bit of an engage. Theo's looking for his way in. Spires is looking for Wayne as well. Super Mega Death Rocket. It's popped. They're in on top of Dragoon. He burns the flash from the heal, and he's going to survive. The Death Charge just will not do enough. Sakroza is going to take You Know the Kid into the Death Realm. We'll pick one back up for himself. But Dragoon is still alive. Manages to survive with both summoners. And I think it looks like with the Baron in their pockets, DZG might just be able to end this game.
I believe they might be able to. They do have quite a lot of damage. CP Galaxy does have 20 second death timer, so I believe this should just, especially with Jinx getting excited from now from structures, we'll be able to start hitting these Nexus towers.
Yeah, High Legacy doing his best to try and defend. End of the line has respawned. Nice steadfast presence from Ability Scooter to deny him. And I think the respawn timers are just a little bit too short. It doesn't look like DZG are going to be able to end the game just yet. Now have to make sure that they can get out of the base before any sort of CBG response can come through.
Fair. They have bear recalls. They'll be fine. Now, opting in for those resets, Jinx getting looking towards that LDR second. Could possibly maybe opt in for Mortal Reminder now that still has the armor pen with the
added bit of anti-heal. Yeah, that is a good item now. I almost forgot.
Yeah. Recent AD carry changes are really nice and cool. But DZG now clearing his vision of this mount of this Cloud Drake. Should just be able to take it for free. CB Galaxy should not opt in to try and contest this. They're very far behind in gold now. Almost more than 10k gold behind. And it's just almost smooth sailing for these of you to just walk down mid, walk down bot, and just push into the space.
Yeah, and like we had said, Cloud Soul, while it is still a soul, it's not the scariest to be looking down the barrel of. You're still saying, okay, it's not Infernal Soul. They're not hitting us with a massive amount of damage. It's not Mountain Soul. They're not unkillable. It's Cloud Soul. They're going to be a little faster when they cast their ultimate. It's going to be harder for us to disengage, but that's fine. We turtle up in our base. We buy some more items. We get our Mordekaiser to 3 items. We get our Sylas to 3 items. We get Caitlyn 3 or 4 items. We can make it. It's just going to be a matter of can we get those items in inventory, because you are looking at a nearly 4-item Jinx, a nearly 3-item Victor, a Poppy who is looking nigh unkillable in this game, despite the 2 deaths happening early in the game. This is just a very difficult situation for CB Galaxy to find themselves in, and we'll have to see if they have any sort of way to make a comeback for themselves.
That's true. DZG are being a little hesitant. You know, they don't want to overforce anything too crazy. They don't want to actually throw the lead away. Jinx should now, does now have that 4th item LDR completed, opting in for, I believe, GA as their last item, but like we were just saying, DZG have such a massive item advantage over CB Galaxy. High Legacy now does have the Bloodthirster completed, but I guess the 4-item Jinx, it's not really going to do that much. Especially now that Victor has that Seraph added up to him. Maokai has the Leandre's Demonic, Mobility Scooter, Frostfire,
Iceborne Frostfire God, Sunfire. It's not Frostfire anymore. It's Frozen Fist, because they decided they liked the funny community name for it.
Yeah, bring back old items, please, right?
I do like Frozen Fist as an item name. I think it's very funny. I do miss Frostfire. I think that's a very cool name. But yeah, this is now 13,000 gold in the lead for DZG. It hits the point in the game where it's like, okay, it's no longer on the onus of CB Galaxy to like find a way to win. It's really on DZG to find a way to lose. Do they have like the potential to throw this game enough that CB Galaxy can find a way back into it? And CB Galaxy just has to be sort of ready to find that punish if it ever arrives. That's all they can really do.
Yes, that's, I mean, and if you're a player in this situation, you just, like you said, they need to be on their toes and identify what is DZG doing wrong, what can they punish from it. But right now, DZG playing this really, really well. They're not really making that much mistakes. They're not giving CB any option to try to force a play.
Yeah, I'm gonna be honest, as compared to this first game, this DZG team looks like a different set of 5 players. They are playing the macro beautifully. They know exactly what they want to do on the map. They are basically leading CB Galaxy by the leash around the map to where they need to go. And it's gorgeous League of Legends. They fed all their gold to the AD carry. Their mid laner has some as well. But this is just exactly how you want to see a late game scaling comp be played. I can't imagine a situation where this is played any better.
Exactly, especially since how laning phase was kind of put out towards Spires, not being able to get as much pressure as he was in that first game on the Vex. As the Silas right now hasn't been able to find much, especially in these sort of earlier team fights and more towards the late games, hasn't just been able to do anything at all. Anikis being able to just do what he wants. And I think most of DZG's like playmaking has been on the back of Angry Peasant and Anikis getting pressure mid. getting pressure bombing and just letting Dragoon, Mogozer just play how they want to play and just do whatever they want.
Yeah, DZG is just gonna sit and camp the respawn of this inhibitor, make sure that it stays down. I think the one thing I would say about their play right now is they're playing a little bit too heavily around mid. They should be looking to push down this top turret and this bottom turret and make sure that there is multiple super minions pushing into the base, because right now they have just been giving golden experience to Caitlyn and to Sylas, which is, you know, at this point in the game, it's probably a little too late. However, in terms of, like, correct, quote-unquote, League of Legends play, you don't want to take the inhibitor before you're ready to end the game, as you are giving the enemy team a lot of gold, and you're also denying yourself a lot of gold and XP, as that super wave is going to be constantly pushing into their base. But now DZG have decided that they're going to take this top lane inhibitor. The bottom lane has a wave as well, so they could very easily just walk down to it, take all three inhibitors, play this as clean as possible. And it's going to be on CB Galaxy trying to find some way to punish. Like we said earlier, they need to find some sort of misstep from this DZG comp. Looking for the all in the nature's grass. Change through! It's the four-man encore from You Know the Kid! You know his name! Dragoon goes to Legendary, and the teamfight is just blown up in favor of DZG. You Know the Kid is going to get pulled into the death round, but I don't know if Sakroza is going to actually have the damage to find the kill. You Know the Kid survives the death round. And DZG is going to take us to game 3.
Very well played. I think in terms of micro and macro play, this DZG was almost spot on. They were there when they did the plays that they wanted to do, and how they did it was perfect. Especially when we go back to that mid lane and Cloud Dragon fight, they know their limits. They know what they can do and what they should do at the right moment.
Yeah, that was, like we said a few times there, pretty much perfect play. You got all of your kills onto the AD carry. You fed them as much gold as they could want. You kept them safe in the team fights. Dragoon played the team fights well, was positioned correctly. It's hard to say more than that. I don't even think CB Galaxy played poorly. I think their one big mistake was on that first Cloud Dragon, just trying to contest it as well as defending their mid lane. They sort of made two separate calls and didn't end up committing fully to either one of them, which gave DZG the best of both worlds. But from there, it wasn't really, the game was not really in their hands. It was really just DZG in the pilot seat saying, hey, we've got control of the game. We're not letting go.
No, they did not let go. They did not take a foot off the gas. And now, if you're CB Galaxy, you just got to think, how do we play this? How do we play differently? What did we do wrong in this game? And how can we adjust the draft to see what we can do to take this game.
Yeah, and adjust the draft. We will have to see if they do as we take a short break before game 3. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Welcome to the world, no heroes and villains. Welcome to the war, we've only begun. So pick up your weapon and face it. There's blood on the crown, go and take it. You get one shot to make it out alive. So higher and higher you're chasing. It's deep in your bones, go and take it. This is your moment. Now is your time, so prove yourself and rise, make them remember you.
Tomorrow.
We are back for our draft of game three, our final game of tonight of DZG versus CBG. A lot of G's, and joining me is ICGE. How are we looking at this draft so far?
Well, if you look at the bands, pretty much there's the same three bands throughout the entirety of this. Actually, Maokai does get banned away, so it'll be interesting to see what they do opt in for their B1 pick. I believe out of all these, it's the Vex and the Anivia that has not been banned away just yet. Actually, CB opted to pick in the Sejuani first.
Yeah, with the Maokai off the table, Sejuani increases in priority a little bit in terms of these tanky, engaging junglers. We did see CBG got their hands on it in the last draft. They weren't able to do as much with it as I think we would have expected. Dio looked a lot more impressive on the Maokai in game one. But now with the Maokai off the table, both of these junglers are being forced down the tier list a little bit. I wonder if DZG will look for the Jarvan again? Or maybe it's the Amumu. Okay.
Ooh, and the Zac. All right, we're getting a little bit of spicy in this draft right now. If I believe... I think it might be a locked in just Amumu support Zac and jungle, I believe.
I mean, there's like the possibility for Zac mid. I'm not gonna say it's likely, but we have been seeing Zac banned away by CBG in that second round when they get the chance. But this time, DZG not wanting to let it slip through the draft. They're just gonna pick what's comfortable to them. And speaking of comfort, CBG is gonna drop back to that Braum pick in the bot lane.
I hope they don't go for the Ezreal. I don't think it did that much in lane. I think they maybe go for a bit more of a power AD carry. Maybe the Alten go back to all reliable Lucian Braum.
Oh man, before Lucian Nami was the power lane, it was Lucian Braum.
Choose the opt-in for the server, so trying to get their own late game AD carry scaling insurance.
They just lock in Jinx again. It looked so good for Dragoon in game one, and this is again a CBG draft that doesn't have a lot of pressure in the laning phase, so this would be pretty easy to scale for DZG if they wanted to, and they are going to lock it in. That's a Jinx Amumu bottom lane, I think, almost for certain.
I believe so. I don't think Amumu would go anywhere else. I don't see Anakis as a person to maybe play Zac. I think they would try and maybe get him on another AD, like hyper carry champion. A lot of these more, I say, respectable bans, the Vex going all the way again, the same with the Anivia. I don't want to deal with that in the mid lane. Lulu being banned away, keeping that from Jinx, but I think...
Yeah, it seems like CBG has a different read on it than we do. It seems like they're saying, okay, this Zac is not in the jungle. Amumu's going to be your jungler. You haven't locked in your support for your Jinx yet. Or at the very least, they want that flexibility to be open. So they might ban something other than support here. Maybe try and pinch the top lane pool a little bit more. Maybe the mid lane as well. They're going to lock away the Victor. So it seems like CBG is not confident on where exactly this Amumu and Zac are going to end up in this draft. And honestly, neither am I.
I did a little snippet at Mobility Scooter. He has a lot of Zac games in the top lane. So they know more than we do. So they're suspecting quite a bit of flex picks. As Syndra does get locked in for the mid lane. A bit of a, say, safer pick. More of a pretty strong power pick that they can do in the mid lane blind. So it'll be interesting. It's interesting to see what they opt in for their counter pick. Is Dax on top lane and they're counter picking for jungle? Is it still Amumu jungle and they're counter picking support? Kind of unlikely, but it'll be interesting to see that.
Yeah, the Syndra, ever since her mini rework, her mid scope update, she's been a lot stronger in general in terms of mid and support potential. This looks like CBG is going to lock in the Swain, another champion whose mid-scope update really unlocked their potential in the modern meta nowadays. Syndra recently with her new Shards of Wrath or Splinters of Wrath system, a little bit more stacking minigame as Riot seems so like to do. She's been really strong in the meta right now and I think is honestly underplayed by a lot of the professional teams, so I'm excited to see DZG pull this one out for Andakis. And CBG, something that was banned away in the past couple of games, they're finally going to get their hands on the Urgot for Sakroza.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. I don't think they'll opt in for the Zac top. I think they may have a bit more safe. A lot of these top laners are still open. I'll be honest, I don't really know what to get. Actually, a Soraka, so it is an R5 support, so it will Zac top with a Amumu jungle.
This is an insane draft for DZG. I'm gonna be honest. I think this is just so hard winning for them. They have Amumu and Zac for really good teamfight engage and AoE crowd control, Syndra for that single target pick, and a Soraka to make sure that Jinx gets to play the game. This is disgustingly good for DZG.
That's true. But if you take a look at CB side, they have a lot of lockdown. They have the Sejuani R, they have the Braum passive, they have Swain and Urgot. I'm kind of leaning towards, at least in... If CB gets ahead, I'm leaning towards them in the team fights, but I still think, even if CB are ahead, I still think DZG, like you said, they have Amumu ult, they have Zac, they have so much lockdown, and especially Soraka, the queen of support, can just do all that she wants to keep this team alive.
Yeah, it feels like there's a lot of potential counterplay for both comps in this game. It's just going to be a matter of which team do we see? Do we see game one DZG or game two? And are we going to see game one CBG or game two? And I think that's really going to be the decider. Which team is going to be more on it in terms of execution for this third game?
I think in terms of execution, I think DZG have it a little bit more easier than I'd say CBG. Just with the Zac leap, just of how much more range it has over Sejuani, I think it would just be a little bit more easier for DZG to look for plays bot lane, look for plays mid lane. However, if Swain does go untouched, if he gets that Rod of Ages stack, which I think he could opt in for the Rod of Ages or opt in for the Liandry's, but if Swain does get a bit of a head, it'd be very hard to deal with him in these team fights, especially if Sivir can also at the same time stay quite ahead against this Jinx.
Yeah, it is going to be, once again, I think, very centered around the bottom lanes in this game. Can Jinx scale up to that 3-item power spike? Can she get that Infinity Edge in inventory before Sivir can? Can Sivir Braum bully the lane out enough versus this Soraka? Soraka is a champion that is notoriously difficult to bully out of lane, so Poke is a lot less effective against her, especially with certain build paths that include a Moonstone and a Second Wind. It's just so difficult to push her out of lane. It's genuinely, as someone who likes playing like engage supports and poke supports, so hard to play against Soraka in some cases. It's just like, oh, the enemy team has picked Soraka. Suddenly my champion doesn't do enough to outlast her healing, so I'm now just useless in the game.
I think Soraka as a champion has really just completely just gone under the radar for every support player. I think Soraka, especially nowadays, with, like I said, with Moonstone, and with all these support mythics or mythic items, Soraka just she does God's work. She will keep everyone on this team alive if she is allowed to. If she's untouched in any team fight, she will hard carry DZG to winning these team fights, especially for just how semi squishy both Jinx and Syndra are. With the Soraka healing, Jinx and Syndra just won't die.
Yeah, I think it's a tall task for CBG to actually break through this front line that DZG has with the Soraka. It's going to force, at the very least, the Swain, if not the Sejuani as well, to buy that anti-healing to pay that tax into the Soraka. Especially with the anti-heal changes, you can sit on that first item and still have that 40% effectiveness. As much as I'm against that particular change for Riot, it is going to be really good for CBG in this game, as they don't have to fully opt into the Morello and the Thornmail if they really don't want to. I think it will probably still be valuable enough for them to do it, but they can sit on just that early anti-healing in lane and just be okay to hit their item power spikes without paying the full item tax.
I agree. I got not as much. What about you?
Yeah, I think it's just going to be a matter of execution. We're going to have to see how these teams execute as we count down our spectator delay. We'll be taking a short break before we hop into this all-important game 3. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
thought about wreaking havoc on an opposition. Kind of shocking, they want a static with precision. I'm automatic. Quarterback, I ain't talking second. Pack it up, on panic. Batter up, who the baddest?
We are back with our final game of tonight of CB Galaxy versus DZG Sticks. I'm still with you, Brady. This is still ICGE beside me. And we've got a spicy one tonight.
Indeed we do. Although, not a lot much action going on right now, unfortunately. This whole team's still opting for this 5-point. Only kind of upset we still have not seen an invade yet. We did see a little bit of an attempt from CB Galaxy last game. They did get spot out on the ward, so unfortunately, no early fights.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest. I don't think either of these comps really want to early fight either. You have Jinx and Sivir who both really want to just sit in lane and farm until they hit two items. You've got Amumu who doesn't want to start Q to make sure his jungle camps are like easier to clear. As we see, Spires gets 5 extra HP off of that passive, a massive lead in lane, and suddenly Anakis cannot play the game.
That's yeah, something I think... we wish we all said.
Yeah, both of these teams are very comfortable just sitting back and getting to that mid and late game. Though I will say, I think if we get past the 25-minute mark and we get to the 3 items for 80 carries, DZG is probably better.
I agree. I think Jinx overall overshadows Sivir, especially in these late game fights. If they're even, Jinx hard wins. I think Jinx just has more upfront damage, especially with those rockets. Sivir, see more consistent damage throughout the entirety of DZG's team, but Jinx's rockets hurt a lot more. She has more range over Sivir, especially when she does end up getting that lethal tempo proc. So it'll just be a battle of who can get ahead in the spot lane first.
Yeah, I'm gonna say I called it out in draft, and I'm a little disappointed to see. You know, the kid has bone plating and not second wind versus Sivir, and I think that's personally, in my opinion, the incorrect choice. I think second wind on Soraka just feels so good, especially into lanes where you are picking up excess damage, like these Sivir ricochets, or just getting tagged by a stray Braum Q every once in a while. It will mean that there's less upfront burst, but you know the kid will have less sustain if these Qs start to get dodged.
Yeah, quite a bit of a blunder. Very, very unfortunate that that is what is conspiring, but both junglers kind of just doing what they want in the mid lane right now. Angry Peasant is looking for the swain. He's kind of inching forward, but
yeah, I think he did get spotted just inside vision. Spires will simply walk towards his top side, knows his jungler is up there, is feeling comfortable with that one. And we haven't talked about it at all, but we do have a Zac top here in this game versus the Urgot. I'm going to say a surprising pick. I know you mentioned that Mobility Scooter does play this one, but this is not something I think I have especially ever seen. I know G2 picked up the Zac mid a couple weeks ago at this point, but Zac top is still a new one to me.
Yes, it is. I've had my very small shares of Zac's top, but very rarely have I seen it be kind of a bit more of an actual pick. I think it's more or less of just a comfort champion. It'd be interesting to see how it plays into the Urgot, but if you look at the CS right now, fairly even, although the Mobility Scooter does have a bit of a health disadvantage, but I think it'll just be interesting to see how he plays out this lane in the future.
Yeah, and we're kind of expecting Zac to have that health pool deficit in this lane, not only with the Urgot poke, but also just has to spend his health to get more health.
That's true. Actually kind of looking in for a top lane play. It has been sitting on the mid bush.
Yeah, Mobility Scooter's gonna get found out here. He does have the passive. He's gonna be able to flash and jump his way away. Loses his flash, but he is gonna survive the exchange and waste a lot of Dio's time, so not exactly the best outcome, but you don't die, so we take this.
Yeah. Not the worst outcome, but Angry Peasant is gonna be able to get some of these camps away from Dale's. We know that they know they always top fight, so should just be a free Krugs to be taken away. Spires actually did walk down towards the red buff. Maybe he's thinking Scrappy, not Scrappy, Angry Peasant, sorry. Used to that name. But trying to hover around, make sure to try to see if you get any information of Angry Peasant, but nothing to be found.
Yeah, I do like that walk from Spires. He's going to be recalling anyway just to get back to base. So you might as well walk towards the bottom side in case Angry Present does try and make some sort of counterplay happen on the bottom side. If he's not happy enough just taking the Krugs away, wants to try and make some sort of bot lane gank or bot lane dive happen. Spires wants to be in place to make sure that it cannot.
Yes, especially now that he's ever inching so close to level 6, then Swain starts to become quite a bit more of a nuisance as the wheel scooter does get flipped.
Cool. Angry Present finds the bandage toss in. They're going to force the flash out of Sacroza. That's a very safe flash. I don't actually know if they had the damage to kill the Urgot there, but it's better to burn the flash and not die than to not burn the flash and be like, oh, they did more damage than I expected. I guess I die.
Well, with that being said, they saw Angry Present on top. I so cool. The free Cloud Dragon. And for the first time, we will not get a Cloud Rift. So hopefully we'll be seeing a little bit more variety. As now the Cloud Dragon is dead, we will now have a Inferno Drake as a second dragon. So more of a spicier pickup for the Drake Rift.
No Cloud Soul Game 3. We love to see it. We do also see Sacroza picking up the early anti-heal versus this Zac. Knows that this game is going to have a lot of healing in it. We already see High Legacy as well, picking up the early anti-heal ingredients, just making sure that they're going to keep the Soraka and the Zac down. I think this is a smart decision. It doesn't feel good, but it's probably the correct decision.
Yes, it's the correct decision. As the AZG, I think he can make a play with the Spires. Scavenger does miss.
Yeah, Spires is just going to pull Angry Present back for about 10 HP. Just get a little bit of extra HP for himself. Doesn't feel too bad about that one.
But going back to these execution picks, I think on Sivir especially, I'm not a huge fan of an early executioners against into a Soraka lane, especially if since you're playing Sivir, you want to get as much gold as you can into your first or second item. And I think it kind of stunts her a little bit compared to the Jinx, who is not that much CS ahead, but it's still a little noticeable difference.
Yeah, Sivir is really not the person you want the anti-heal item to be on, as Andicus is going to get a very hefty trade in the mid lane. The Unleash Power as well, just going to burn through a lot of the Swain's HP, force that recall out. But yeah, despite the changes to the crit items, with the Mortal Reminder being a lot better of an item now, it grants Armor Pen as well as the crit and the anti-heal, it's still not the person you want it to be on. You know Swain is probably going to have the Liandry's Torment in this game, so you would love to see it on him. You know Sejuani is going to be getting auto-attacked by pretty much everybody, so you want to see Thornmail on her. Even Urgot has, like, some AoE, so you're fine to see anti-heal on him. Sivir is probably the last person in this comp that you want to be spending that gold towards the anti-heal item, because you just want Sivir to hit that 2-3 item power spike before Jinx does.
Yeah. Not to say that Sivir can't or shouldn't build anti-heal, but certainly not this early on, especially early on, there's not that much healing to be getting rid of, honestly. Yes, it's Soraka's healing may look a bit high, but it's only level 5. It doesn't even have the wish unlocked, so not much to be stopped as
Sacroza is getting engaged in on the top side. The Curse of the Sad Mummy plus the Less Bounce. Gonna do enough damage to burn through, but now the return gank. A nice flash is scattered a weak from Anakin. Is gonna fight the 2-man stun, but are they gonna be able to continue this play off of it? Spires is still at full HP. Anger Present is gonna tank up that Glacial Prison, but a really nice pull back from Spires. The wish comes through from You Know the Kid, but it's just a little too late. It's a double kill for Spires in retribution on that top side.
That was really, very well played by CB Galaxy. They own Spires, knowing if they land their CC and if they land their ultimates, they can burst down one of the members of DZG. A really good pull from Spires to pull in. I believe he pulled in Anigas that was quite far away. Get them into Swain's ultimate and just Swain just drain tanking, doing whatever he wants.
Line wants the engage here, burns the exhaust to get the flash out of You Know the Kid. The Glacial Fissure is gonna find her going. The exhaust comes through on the High Legacy as well. The stun comes through, plenty of damage coming through, but the Soraka healing, even with the anti-heal, is so influential. How do you kill this Jinx? She's out of mana now, so the chase through is gonna be a lot harder. You Know the Kid is baiting for Angry Presence. Oh, the bandage toss will find its mark. Dragon picks up one kill, picks up two. Beautiful counter engage from the DZG bottom lane.
If you want to keep your AD carry alive, just pick Soraka. She's dope.
Champion is so good!
Even with the anti-heal, still, like, we kind of go back to the argument, she still pumped out so much healing in that team fight. Or, not team fight, but more or less a skirmish. keeping Dragoon alive. And now we're kind of seeing a repeat of last game. Dragoon is now 2-0 onto this Jinx, but in CB's favor, they do have a Swain that is pretty fed right now. He's about 1,000 gold off of the Leandrin, so it'll be interesting to see how these team fights in the future play out.
Yeah, I will say Swain has not picked up the anti-heal component yet, so even with that AoE and with the Leandrin's burn, he won't be applying that 40% Grievous. It's just going to be on Sivir and on Sakroza right now. And like we were talking about, delaying Sivir from that power spike, especially now that she's behind in this lane, it feels so bad for her to be delaying her power spike. And like we saw what Soraka could do, even through the anti-heal. She was still pumping out 100 health every time she pressed that W button. And it's only going to get worse from here as she completes her Moonstone, as she gets what I'm assuming is going to be Mikhail's or Ardent Sensor, or honestly, whatever anti-heal or whatever shielding item she wants.
I'd hope maybe she might opt into either of the Mikhail's, like you said. Although Dragoon does have Cleanse on him, so not necessarily needed. But I think maybe a Chemtech Putrefier, I believe that's what the item name is. I think that item on its own will just be great.
Actually, see a skirmish here in the bottom lane, and then the line trying to find his way, but Angry Present with the counter engage, a nice 3-man curse of the sad mummy. The Dragoon now forced to flash away. The Glacial Vision will not find him. He's gonna be able to walk away from that one. The Braum stacks are gonna fall off, and it's just gonna be a couple of flashes and ults burned. No kills given over. The Rift Herald, I think, made contact with that tower. I wasn't paying too much attention to it. So that was about a plate and a half worth of damage onto that tower for split among two or three people.
It does end up going in CB's favor. Not able to get a kill. That Skrull does miss the flip, but without the playing the boss side, that is a 3 Infernal Dragon. If we kind of think about back to that last play, again, the Soraka healing. I saw 100 and then 176 healing from just two buttons, and the Chemtech Drake will now be the Rift. So if DZ can come back from this little dragon deficit and start stacking these Chemtech Drakes, this Soraka would be doing so much more healing.
Yeah, hey, did you know Chemtech Dragon gives you not only the Tenacity, which is already an incredibly good stat into this CB Galaxy lineup, it also gives you heal and shield power. So the Soraka's healing, which is already very good for this early in the game, is only going to get better from here if DZG can manage to stabilize these deficits that they're in and find themselves a stronger lead, play more around this Jinx, get her more gold, stabilize this mid lane, make sure Spires doesn't get too far ahead. Suddenly, it feels like this is, again, DZG's game to win.
Yeah, especially if they can start slowly stacking up these Drakes, and if you kind of look at the item differences, Anikis does have that Ludens completed. Spires is now recalling, so should be able to pick up that Leandre's, maybe even get tier 2 boots. Dale does have the Radiant Virtue. So right now, CB Galaxy quite ahead in terms of items. If you look at the bot lane, Dragoon is now reset. I'm assuming he should have Kraken Slayer right now, so bot lane pretty decently strong. You know the kid, getting ever so close to that Moon Soul as well.
Yeah, I think the only thing I would be really disappointed by is if you know the kid ends up going for the Shirelias. I feel like his team doesn't particularly need much more mobility once Jinx gets that reset. Amumu and Zac already have such long engage range, it's so difficult to get away from them already. I would love to see, you know, the kid just go straight for the Moonstone, say, hey, I am only here to make sure that Jinx stays alive. I don't care about anything else in this game. I do like the Swiftness boots as a choice. I am normally the Soraka player who greeds for those CDR boots almost every time. I love having the lower cooldown on my ultimate and my flash. But I think the Swiftness boots are probably better in this situation. It's just going to be a little bit safer versus this Braum slow, versus the eventual Sejuani slow coming out from her ultimate. It's going to provide a lot of value for the Soraka.
Yeah, especially if Spires does opt in for the Rylai's Crystal Scepter second item, which is an option, so that might allow you know, the kid to be a bit more careful, especially when it comes to these team fights, because if CB want to win these future fights, they need to kill the Soraka. Two fights already in the bot lane have shown just the power of the Soraka, even with the anti-heal. They need to burst down Soraka. They cannot go for Dragoon, they can't go for Angry Present. They have to burst this Soraka down.
Yeah, this is really the power of Soraka picks in these sorts of team compositions. While you really want to put all your damage into Jinx and try and blow her up before the fight can, like, give her a reset, with a Soraka behind her, it's so difficult to do that. So you want to focus all your resources onto the Soraka, but it feels so counterintuitive to be ignoring a Jinx who's just beating away at your backliners. And speaking of beating away at your backliners, they're gonna go for a dive on the bottom side of the flash. Two-man curse of the sad mummies are going. We'll pick up that kill and drop that tower aggro as well. End of the line. He's getting close to death, but is gonna be able to walk away from this one just fine. Anger present. He's gonna land the bandage toss again on the Sakroza, taking so much damage. The Super Mega Death Rocket. Flashed away by Sakroza, sacrifices his support to stay alive. Damn, that feels bad for End of the Line.
Like, we're seeing the game two side of DGG. They're doing 4-0, just having a complete run back of the second game. Daniel Spires trying to do what they can. I believe they just killed the Retro, but DGG, very well played, very, very organized dive onto the tower, trying to see if they can get the second tier two down. Or yeah, tier two.
Yeah, they're gonna take away about half of his HP. You know, the kid has to be a little bit careful. The Spires is on the way. There's a potential for a pick at the end of this play, but I don't think they're gonna be able to find it. It looks like DZG will be able to walk away. Yeah, at the very least, in terms of what's potentially here for CBG, they do have Sivir this time as opposed to the Caitlyn. I think Sivir has a little bit better late game scaling, can have a little bit more teamfight presence. As long as she can get to that second item, that Infinity Edge, or sometimes even the Navori, as we see Sivir's go. As long as she's not sidetracking herself to go Bloodthirster or to build this full anti-heal item, she should be okay in teamfights. It's just going to be a matter of, does she know how to build correctly?
Does she know how to build correctly, and can she get there in time? Chemtech Drake is spawning up. Sivir has not backed yet. She's very stunted in terms of her items compared to the Jinx that has Crankster and a BF sword. Although all five members of CB are here.
Yeah, this is a lot of pressure for this third dragon. CB do not want to give any of these Chemtech dragons to this Soraka comp, to this Zac. They don't want to give over the tenacity either. They want to make sure that they have full control over this pit. Anger Present doesn't have Curse of the Sad Mummy, but all the rest of the ultimates are up for DZG. That Wish just now coming off of cooldown. Ability Scooter looking for his way in, dives in. They found Spires. All the damage is coming through. He's blown up and deleted. Dragoon is getting pressured down, but they immediately turn back to peel this Jinx. She is now back up to half HP. They're going to give up Zac's passive in response, but Jinx is still untouched. It's a triple kill for Dragoon. They're going to go after High Legacy. There's going to flash away, and it's just all DZG in the fight. Beautiful turn to peel their Jinx. Great team fight.
And yet again, Dragoon is denied another quadra kill, another triple kill added to his board. But like you said, very, very well played by DZG, keeping Dragoon alive. I didn't really pay much attention to see how Soraka played a portion into that fight, but we did see the Wish come out. And obviously, since how that was a 4-0, I believe, in favor of DZG, Soraka did a lot of work. Angry Present, the Christmas Head movie did come out, so very well played by DZG.
Yeah, I really liked the way that as soon as the Swain was blown up, as soon as he was out of the fight, Angry Present immediately turns around on the Sejuani. No hesitation, just immediate bandage toss to keep Dragoon alive, not give over that shutdown gold. And that is so important for CBG. If they can pick that one up, they're gonna feel a lot more comfortable in this game. Like, if they can give that to Sivir, give that to Swain, suddenly, like, your carries are back in this. You can potentially find a 5v5. But finding a 5v5 in that situation is so hard. Like you were talking about before the fight, the item disadvantage between the AD carries was so big, and despite the fact that your mid lane has a lead, it's still Mythic and components versus Mythic and components. Too many S's. Syndra will still be effective, even if it's just Ludens plus like an Amp Tome or plus a Hextech Alternator, as effective as Swain will be with Liandry's plus Boots.
Yeah, CB trying to get this Rachel a bit of an MVP. I actually do look to go again. They're going 2,000, almost 3,000 gold up.
Jesus.
This is the power of Jinx. She is currently sitting on the Kraken and IE, back running it back again from game two. V being very, very powerful and very strong. I believe Soraka is almost there towards this Moonstone. Top lane, kind of a bit of a...
Oh, Spires might be able to pick this one up. The pull in is good, the damage is there, but Soraka is just so good. Dragoon is going to stay alive. It's a double kill for Mobility Scooter. And somehow at the end of that fight, Dragoon is over three quarters HP. He's going to be full as soon as you know the kit presses W again. And that's just going to be barren for DZG.
Very, very, very close for Dragoon there. Almost dead. Does go down. Probably close to... Probably, honestly, less than 100 HP in that fight, but the power was still locked to kill. Even without the Moonstone, and now without only just the Kentai Drake, a lot of increased healing as Lizard does get the form of Deo.
Can't get aggressive on it, doesn't find the Elastic Slingshot. Deo just having a little bit of fun with it, knowing he gets away. But yeah, that's how good Soraka is. That was with the anti-heal from Sivir. Dragoon had already been knocked down a little bit in terms of HP. He had taken a lot of Sivir ricochets. There was plenty of damage already onto this Jinx alongside that anti-heal. And they still couldn't burst through her health bar. Thank you, Soraka. Honor your supports.
And it's only going to get more difficult from here. Soraka does end up picking up that Moonstone.
It's looking... It's about a second.
I actually, does that item build into Night's Vow? I'm not
sure. It's either Night's Vow or Warmogs, because the only other thing that thing builds into is the Heartsteel.
But you can't really build Heartsteel when you
have Moonstone. Not when you have Moonstone, so I have to assume that that's going to be just a Night's Vow to make sure that Dragoon stays alive. I mean, as Soraka, you don't particularly care about your KDA. As long as Jinx is alive, you've done your job. So I don't hate it. I think it's okay.
Yeah, I think it'll work. As long as, like you said, as long as the aid carry stays alive, you're doing your job. You're doing very, very well. And if we kind of talk about the itemization, Mobility Scooter does have that Radiant Virtue. So in the event that Jinx does get dove on, Mobility Scooter can just press R and start slowly and surely pumping out extra healing onto this. Onto this Jinx. And Angry Present, well, actually, all members of DG, aside from the Soraka, are now sitting on their two fully complete items. So they are very strong, very ahead. 7k, no, 6k gold. I can't do math, sorry.
Yeah, around 6,500 gold in their lead. Mobility Scooter is gonna find the dive, but I don't think they're just gonna commit to it. They just wanna grab that tier 1 tower and walk away. Just taking advantage of the non-committal engage that they have, just saying, hey, we could threaten to dive, we could go for it, but we're not gonna. But we could!
That's the threat of it being there. We kind of look at the items, actually no, not the items, we're going for a dragon play. Dragon is 25 seconds. DG do have vision of the Drake, now trying to get a little more mid-prod back up, but Zekroza doing a bit of a split pushing, trying to see if they can get those objective bounties off that tower.
Yeah, I think this is really smart for Sakroza. They know that they can't win a 5 versus 5. This is also just second dragon for DZG. You're not the most threatened by this. You can try and threaten the tier 2 tower that Sakroza is doing in that top side. Look to potentially play for tier 1 tower in mid as well. Mobility Scooter is just going to stop him from grabbing the tier 2, pull him back, get a little bit of damage, but I don't think the Zac is really in any sort of a position to 1v1 this Urgot right now. Even just the Black Cleaver in inventory is a little bit too much damage for Zac to deal with solo.
Yeah, I believe Zac not the greatest damage dealer. I think more or less just frontline tank and also disruption, especially with his ultimate. Especially if High Legs, he can just not be able to move.
Yeah, I want to point out also, End of the Line has opted for the Even Shroud this game. I don't know how much I like that, just given how much damage this CB Galaxy composition already has. It doesn't feel like it really needs the extra percentage damage on top of that. It feels like it really could use the Lock into the Iron Solari just to make sure that Sivir and the Swain stay alive long enough to do their damage. So we'll have to see how much effectiveness it has, like, closer to the end of this game. Maybe I'm wrong in the way that I'm looking at this, but I feel like Locket or maybe even something like Iceborne Gauntlet would have been a little bit more effective.
Possibly, or maybe could opt in for maybe the Radiant Virtue and have Deo and End of Line both have that. Because they want to stay on top of High Legacy. They want to make sure he's safe and survives, but I kind of agree. Even Shab, not the greatest support mythic. I do agree with Lockett. Probably should have been the purchase here, but could see how the rest of the game does unfold.
Mobility Scooter casually just gonna tank the tower and threaten Spire enough to force out the Demon Flare, but Anakin's in the meantime on the bottom side of the map is gonna get threatened a little bit and looks for the burst on the High Legacy with the shield plus the heal is gonna be enough to keep High Legacy alive. So Kroza will pick up Anakin's and they'll grab another tower for themselves. Kroza is gonna teleport up to this top side, but I don't know if this is exactly where he wants to be. He's gonna flash away. Perfect timing on the E jump back is gonna keep him alive. He will still have to lose his flash and his teleport, and they'll still lose that top tower, but it's still not the worst play. They got the response on the bottom side of the map that they were looking for.
Yeah, it's not the worst play. They did manage to pick up that objective bounty, trying their best to swing as much gold as they back can into their favor with the Chem Tech Drake now spawning up in 2.5 minutes. Baron now also spawning in 40, so if you kind of look at the gold graph, forgot. Now, comfortable gold lead, and I guess still almost basically 2k over Spires, and I feel like a bot lane.
Yeah, if you want to just look at the bot lane real quick, that's close to 4,000 gold lead for Dragoon right now. That is what I would call a comfortable lead for the AD carry.
Yes, that's basically an entirely completed item in favor of Dragoon. LDR completed as third, makes sense. Sakroza, Dale, Spires, they have a lot of HP. It'll just be very easy pickings for Dragoon if she can end up getting some of those resets, especially with just how much damage Jinx does now.
Yeah, and DCG is just immediately going to turn onto this Baron as soon as it spawns. CV Galaxy is not far away. Spires is here looking for the engage, but is just going to get blown up. Burns the stopwatch. Nice timing on that Zhonya's anger present now in the backline. A nice curse of the sad money, but there's no follow-up just yet. Dragoon forced to cleanse and flash away. This might be the fight that CVG was looking for. They're going to pick up the Soraka, but Dragoon is still untouched. It's 2 kills for the Jinx. It's 3 kills for the Jinx. She's found her way into the fight. Sakroza is looking for the threat, but this is an excited Jinx with a fully stacked lethal tempo. This is not the person you want to face check. But it's still a 3-for-3, and in the position that CBG was in, you have to call that a winning fight.
Yes, you do, especially of how that fight started out. You know the kid was caught up quite in a bad situation. Soraka was forced to flash away from the Swain R and just had to kite back and keep the Jinx alive. Jinx also had to force the flash and cleanse away, so kind of a bad positioning for DZG's bot lane, but in the end, CB. After they get the initial two picks, or maybe three, decided to keep chasing towards the Jinx, but they were clumped up, Jinx had rockets, and the crits were just coming left and right. Jinx was able to save DZG from almost a bad play, and almost a free Baron for a CB.
Yeah, again, you still have to call that like a winning position for CB, and if you harken back to game two, we talked about it a little bit. The game getting to a point where it's less about the correct plays that you make and it's more about the mistakes that your opponent makes. I think we're getting close to that point, and we saw what happens when DZG makes a mistake there. And speaking of DZG potentially making a mistake, they have sent two down towards this dragon, but the Baron is immediately started up in response. So Mobility Scooter and an Angry Peasant are going to rotate over and just force them straight off of it. They saw the Jinx and the Soraka rotating over and immediately peeled away. Nice call from CB.
I like this call that DZG are opting to do now. They're sending in their bot lane to pick up this Kemta Drake while the rest of the DZG hover around this towards this Baron. Because I think, in their minds, and for honestly, for my opinion, I think it's fine if you give this Baron for your third Chemtech Drake. Just because of how much healing and shielding power, as well as tenacity you're currently getting right now. I think it's fine to just give CB one Baron, or maybe even just harass them to make sure that he can't even get it entirely.
I think with the lead you have, giving them Baron is not necessary. I think you're, like you said, I think you're fine to do it just because of the lead you have, and there's not a lot that they can actually get done with the Baron. But it's still gold in their pockets from getting it, and it's also the denial of a Baron that you could have. So I don't think DZG wants to give it up if they don't have to, and I think they made a really good call to just immediately peel away from the dragon as soon as they saw that CB was stepping towards the Baron, converge resources, make them peel off of it, and they forced them off of the Baron without giving up the dragon either.
Well, now we see a lot of ping going on with the Baron. They did. I believe they did manage to spot out Sokrozek and Emberlion on the bot lane, so it's just a green light. Go, go, go. First Baron for any members of CBG can respond.
Yeah, Dio's in the area, but I think he's just going to be too little too late. That is another Baron secured for DZG, their second of the game, now at 30 minutes. But Sokroza, again, I think playing really nicely on the side lane is just making sure that the threat is there. He's going to force the TP out from Andakus, make sure that there is some threat on the side lane so that DZG doesn't just pick up this Baron for free.
That's how top lane should play.
Gets the bandage toss, but I don't think this is where he wants to be. Sokroza is just gonna hop over the wall thanks to those empowered blast cones from the Chemtech Rift. DZG's now on three Chemtech Dragons. They're feeling fairly powerful, and if they pick up this fourth one, it's gonna be dangerous for CB to take any sort of a fight.
It'd be very difficult, especially I believe each Chemtech drink is, correct me if I'm wrong, I think 7 or 8% heal and shield power, I believe.
6%.
So,
18%. That's already a full item's worth of heal and shield power right there. 18%. Yeah. That's a big number. If they pick up the fourth, that's 24, which is above what the old Mikhail's and Redemption used to be before they got tagged a little bit in the durability update. Yeah, it's a lot of value for Soraka, and also for Zac and Amumu, who are not doing a small amount of healing and shielding with the jungle pet and just with the Zac passive. But we're seeing Sivir with these 2.5 items. She's not someone that you can ignore. These ricochets will do a considerable amount of damage if you stack up in a mini wave and just let her auto attack. And we saw what happened in that team fight. High Legacy, while they didn't do the most, the ricochets had their impact.
Yeah, especially now she's recalling, so I believe she might be opting into, this might be the Mortal Reminder, yes, as she just bought a first set, so she does have the Mortal Reminder, so a bit more anti-heal with also that armor pen. Just trying her best to just get as many items as she can, because she's right now 40 CS down compared to the Jinx, but also 9 kills down compared to this Jinx, so she wants to try to get as much damage as she can. And kind of quickly going back to the Chemtech Drakes, did a little research to give some people some idea. Forbidden Idol gives 8% heal and shield power. Currently, they're just getting that for free on every single member of DZU, so this Rock has
Mobility Scooter strong. Wants to find his way in, gets the Elastic Slingshot in. They found High Legacy, they're gonna burst him all the way down, and Dragoon is still a touch to the fight. They're also, you know, the cave. They're finally gonna get enough damage to take down the Soraka, potentially. She's still alive somehow. Sokroza is gonna find the Fear on the 4, but Dragoon is still untouched. Just hanging out back there. I wonder if that's some sort of disconnect. Andakus is here looking for damage. Mobility Scooter still on the front line. Dragoon, I think, some sort of computer issue. I'm not entirely certain. I think they're back now. But Spires is looking for any sort of defense with this Demon Flayer. It is going to finally run out of Mobility Scooter, finds the Elastic Slingshot, pulls them back in away from the Super Mega Death Rocket. But right there, that was the power of Soraka. Dragoon survives that whole fight. The only ones going down being You Know the Kid and Angry President, and that is going to be Game 3 going the way of DZG.
That was such a very, very close fight. A little, yeah, like you said, probably some technical issues from Dragoon. Could have, if CB had played a little bit better, and they probably could have maybe gotten the kill onto Dragoon there and maybe swung the game a little bit in their favor, but with how far DZG are, it's very unlikely that just one single kill onto the Jinx would impact the game that much. But again, very well played by the Soraka. The power that she was able to manage in that team fight alone just proves of how strong this pick is.
Yeah, I wonder if we can jump to the graphs real quick. I want to see how much healing and shielding Soraka actually was able to output at that point in the game, because it looks like she was outputting so much in every fight. Yeah, ally healing, 15,000, a little bit over that in terms of full healing, so just a little bit for herself. But that is just so much that you have to respect. And this is with the early anti-heal pickups that everybody on CB Galaxy had opted for. This is how strong this champion is in the meta right now. If you give her an AD carry that can scale, that can protect her in the mid game and make sure that she has room to heal you, it's so difficult to play against.
I also like to point out that Jinx took 19,000 damage and Soraka healed for almost 19,000. So just more... more fuels to the fire of that. Soraka, not a balanced pick at all.
Yeah, incredibly well played. DZG, a little bit shaky in that game one, but looked really nice in game two and three. And again, I won't say that CB Galaxy played bad, because I don't think they did. They had a really impressive showing in game one, took full control of the map, took advantage of the passivity that DZG was showing, but then just sort of got led by the leash in game two and three, and DZG got to play their game.
Yeah, I agree. I think in game three, there was some shiny moments in game three. I think they could have potentially bounced back, but I think just very small minor mistakes kind of led to their downfall, led to Jinx getting as fed as she was in game two, and just kind of just ends up just being game over as soon as the Jinx starts to get these kills all over again.
Yeah, this is what happens when you get a scaling AD carry pick safely through the laning phase. But speaking of getting through to the late game, that is going to be it for us for this production. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, ICGE, for joining us. And also, thank you, Massive Sass, Ali, our production, doing an incredible job every stream, as everybody should know by now. Thank you all so much for joining us. Hopefully you'll be here for the next stream that we do. I'm not sure if I will be, but I hope you will be. We'll see you all then. Take care.